Scheduled programs will not be seen at this time so that we may bring you the following live coverage of the U.S. Open Golf Tournament from Pebble Beach, California.
You're looking at the fifth hole, par 3, 180 yards, at the Pebble Beach Golf Links. In the yellow sweater, the leader, Jack Nicklaus, at even par. The man who defeated Nicklaus for the championship at Marion last year, in an 18-hole playoff, 71-74, Lee Trevino, bogeyed the second and third holes and is three over, or three shots off the lead, as they play their head-to-head match. And there's a good look through the chute of the tee shot necessary to come over this bunker and to a very difficult green. And the pin placement is not easy as we look at Trevino's tee shot. And Trevino has found sand before the fifth green here at Pebble Beach. He is three over. And Lee just said something about unplayable, but he can hit them out of the sand, don't worry. Jack Nicklaus started out today at even par. He has won two Open championships, 1962, 1967 at Baltusrol, trying to win his third and the second leg of the Grand Slam. There is a high wind coming off Carmel Bay today. And believe me, when these leaders get on the back nine here at Pebble Beach, you will see scores fluctuating. Arnold Palmer is only one shot off the lead, as is Kermit Zarley at one over. But here's number one, Jack Nicklaus at the fifth hole. Long. Perfect line, but long, just on the fringe behind the fifth green. Live from Pebble Beach Golf Links in Pebble Beach, California. It's the final round of the United States Open Golf Championship. Sports Exclusive is brought to you by Texaco and the many thousands of Texaco retailers and distributors in all 50 states. Trust Texaco to have the right gasoline for you. By Chevrolet, building a better way to see the USA. By Sears Craftsman Power Mowers, powered by the unique Eager One engine. And by Money Mutual of New York. Whether it's life or health insurance, individual or group, it's good to have money in your future. 1 year ago, these two men, Lee Trevino and Jack Nicklaus, following a tie after 72 holes at 280 at Marion in Philadelphia, Trevino went on in an 18-hole playoff the following Monday to defeat Nicklaus 71-74. But it's a little reversed here in 1972 at the 72 Open at Pebble Beach. Jack Nicklaus has a three-shot lead on Trevino as they are the last pair in a field of 70 that have accepted the challenge of the 6,815-yard par 72 golf links just off Carmel Bay. Trevino, 1 foot in, 1 foot out, his second shot on the par 3 fifth. And just like that, he leaves himself a pretty good putt. Looking on is former Open champion, of course, with a great number of announcers like Jim McKay. We have Bud Palmer, Bill Fleming, Frank Gifford, David Marr, Henry Longhurst, and the Open champion, the only one in our announcing staff, Byron Nelson. Pro, what do you think about this win today?
Well, they're really going to have a lot of problems, as the viewers will have the opportunity to see, especially as they come into the last nine holes of play, because there's nothing to block the wind. It's blowing quite strong, and of course, this is what I've been wanting, so the players could really see what this great links can be under bad wind conditions. And you'll see, as you stated earlier, a great fluctuation of scores today. Any man that is one of these leaders that can shoot anywhere near par today will win this championship, because this place, this track is really rough today. And the greens are so small and the rough is so tall that you must play an exact iron or exact shot as well as being controlled, control it so the wind will not put it into one of these bad places. This shot that Leitrist played out of that face of that bunker at that fifth hole was a magnificent shot because the ball always buries in that soft sand, and it's right up against the flag.
All right, as we indicated, Lee Trevino bogeyed the second and third holes to drop two more shots off the lead that is held by Jack Nicklaus by one over Arnold Palmer and Kermit Zarley. This is 4-2 at the par three fifth hole.
Chris, I tell you, this putt of Jack's, you watch it roll here. It is downhill and very, very fast.
We'll be with you for the next 2 hours and 55 minutes on unprecedented coverage of 13 holes here at Pebble Beach. We'll stay with these leaders right on through, missing only the ninth hole, and, oh, it just went forever.
It just looked like it's going to stop, but look, he just looked, he can't hardly believe it. His ball, I don't believe, is any closer than what Trevino was out of the bunker, and it is so fast going down there. We've had this wind that dried the greens out. They didn't water them last night, and they cut them closer. So you're going to see some real difficult golf on this track today.
And, of course, on this fifth hole, you saw the flag a few moments ago, and it was rather limp because on the fifth it does not catch the wind that comes off the ocean. But wait till they get to 17 and 18, for instance, where the wind could move a ball and could affect a putting stroke or the distance that a player might be required to reach. And now we just received word that Arnold Palmer has bogeyed the sixth hole to go two over par. So it's Nicklaus the leader at even par if he makes this putt. Kermit Zarley is one over. Arnold Palmer is two over.
You know, it's that putt, as I said, I believe it's as far away as what Lee played his shot out of the bunker, and Jack is putting first, which means that he putted further away from the hole than what Lee did from playing out of the bunker. So the position you put the ball, whether or not you're putting up to the hole today or whether or not you're putting down, is going to be have a tremendous influence on the winning of this tournament.
Right here, Byron, in this head-to-head match between Nicklaus and Trevino, we could have a swing of two shots if Jack fails to make this one. I should say that Trevino could gain one. The noise you hear is canvas flopping in the wind here behind 18. This action is at the fifth hole. All right, it's going to be a bogey four at the 180-yard fifth hole here at Pebble Beach. Jack Nicklaus, he is one over, tied now with Kermit Zarley for the lead. Ahead, we indicated at the sixth hole that Arnold Palmer bogeyed it to be two over.
Chris,
now Trevino can pick up a shot on Nicklaus.
Chris, you notice that Jack went just over the green here at the fifth. He, of course, watched Lee's shot land just into the bunker short. Very likely had a little influence on Jack's shot, and he wanted to be sure he didn't bury in the bunker. So as a result, he went a little long, and that was a very difficult place to try to get a three from where Jack was. Now Lee, almost a straight-in putt for his three from about 9 feet.
And Lee Trevino is now two over and only one shot away. Correction, that is a par for Lee Trevino. He did gain one on Jack Nicklaus, but he still is three over par as we go to Frank Gifford at the seventh hole.
Par three is playing 101 yards, and as you can see, into a stiff breeze. This is Arnold Palmer. Arnold Palmer at two over par. One shot off the lead.
All right.
And on the green at seven.
It
is ball the furthest away from the pin, the ball of Johnny Miller, nearest to you, one of the most famous golf holes to be found in the world. The ocean on either side, as you can see, the bunkers. It plays 120 from the back of the tee today, playing just a slight bit over 100 yards. As we go now to the sixth hole and Jim McKay.
Kermit Zarley is tied for the lead in the U.S. Open with Jack Nicklaus. He won the Canadian Open 2 years ago, but that's the closest he's ever come to one of the major championships of the world. A former NCAA champion is playing this 515-yard par 5 hole. The ocean is on the right and far behind the green. It's not a problem up by the green there. He's playing his third shot. Zolli tied for the lead in the U.S. Open. Native of Seattle has left his ball short, and he is still off the putting surface, and this is a par 5. He'll have a tough time getting down to 2 from there. This is dead into the wind today. Zolli's playing partner is Bruce Crampton, who at +2 is just one shot out of the lead, one shot behind Nicklaus and Zolli. Back on the tee of the same hole, we have Jack Nicklaus, co-leader in the tournament, once again with Kermit Zolli. Remember, it's Nicklaus and Zolli tied for the lead. Palmer, Homero Blancas, who's playing tremendously well today, and Bruce Crampton, one shot out. Two shots out is Lee Trevino along with Johnny Miller. 23 cameras trying to document this sensational U.S. Open for you just as well as we possibly can. We've gone further back on the golf course than ever before, including this hole, which, remember, is just the 6th. They have a long way to come. Into the wind, Jack Nicklaus hits. And he's hit it off to the left. I can't see yet whether it's in the sand or not. But on the fairway. Okay. Jack Nicklaus has found the fairway safely with his tee shot on the 6th. Now back to 7 and Frank Gifford.
And the twosome of Arnold Palmer and Johnny Miller. If there should be a slight distortion in your picture, it is because some of our cameras that Jimmy mentioned a moment ago, 23 of them, are being worked beyond their normal limits. This is Arnold Palmer. This for a birdie to move into the share of the lead with Jack Nicklaus, about 35 to 40 feet. And sliding by, and Palmer will have a putt of about 18 or 20 inches coming back. And you see the camera situated overlooking this beautiful 7th hole is shaking. That too might be disturbing your picture somewhat. Arnold Palmer with rounds of 77. A lot of people said no, he can't do it. He came back the next day with 68. And yesterday a 73, and the Army was with him. There is the Pacific Ocean. Completely bunkered, this beautiful green.
Frank?
At the par 3 7th. Yes, Byron.
This green is only 30 feet wide, the widest place.
And the pin tucked away in the back. It's even smaller. Palmer with his par 3. We go to Jim McKay.
Here is Kermit Zolli, the co-leader, on the 6th hole. He lies 3 here. Here comes his 4th. On this par 5 hole, he's left himself a putt, but it's certainly one that can be made. A good shot by Kermit Zolli, who took up the game of golf when his father opened a restaurant across the street from a public links in Seattle. And when Kermit wasn't turning the stakes, he would sneak out and see what that game was all about. He found out, got a scholarship to the University of Houston, where he became the NCAA champion, now plays out of a place called Friendswood, Texas. His playing partner, Bruce Crampton. And now back down the fairway, we have Lee Trevino. Remember, this is a big, long par 5. They hit into the flat here. The ocean was on the golfer's right when they started from the tee, but it's no problem to them now. They come straight up a hill. That's what you're doing. You're looking down the face of a hill. If someone were to hit a very low shot, they could hit into the face of that. So Lee is using a wood into the wind right now. He's 2 shots behind Nicklaus and Zolli. Okay. Up over the brow of the hill, short of the green, and that's just where he ought to be. Lee could flip up close. He could get a birdie there. Birdies are so hardly bought, so hardly fought for on this golf course. There's Jack Nicklaus's shot coming up, and he is in the rough, so Jack is going to have trouble. We could have a change in the lead. You're watching ABC's exclusive color coverage of the United States Open Golf Championship. We'll return to the action after this message. We're back again at the 6th green, and this is Bruce Crampton of Australia playing along with Kermit Zolli. Crampton, who is one shot out of the lead at this moment. Waiting for word from our spotter on exactly what he lies at this moment. Bruce putting for his par. He needs this for the par five. And it could almost still fall. Doesn't look like it's going to. A bogey six for Bruce Crampton will drop him down to plus three. He's two shots behind Jack Nicklaus and Kermit Zarley, one behind Arnold Palmer and Homero Blancas. What a day this is going to be. Here's Zarley, who now needs this for his par five to stay in a tie with Nicklaus. But Nicklaus, remember, is in the rough just off this same green and is standing out there, probably up the brow of the hill by now watching Zarley. Zarley always wears an eye shade. A very religious man, Kermit is. Known for that on the tour. He said he won the Canadian Open 2 years ago, but aside from that, you'll not see any of the national championships or the Masters or anything like that in his bag. He's a journeyman member of the professional tour, a good player. But this would mean a great deal to him. Now, on the left, you see Homero Blancas, who has a birdie putt on the eighth hole that could give him a tie for the lead. Homero Blancas making a great comeback today. Zarley for the par has to make this first to stay in the tie, and he did. So Zarley is still tied with Nicklaus. Now, what about Homero Blancas up on eight, who's having a great nine holes? Let's check in with Bill Fleming for that story.
All right, and Homero has the best round going for him so far. Two birdies, no bogeys, and he now, if he makes this putt, can go into a tie for the lead with Nicklaus and Zarley at one over par for the championship. He has more birdies in this championship than anybody else. He has a total of 15. Oh, and it just misses. Skitters by.
Now back to the sixth hole. This is Jack Nicklaus approaching the green where Zarley and Crampton just were. Jack lying two here on this par five hole.
He started out the day at even par. He's one over now. He's had a birdie and two bogeys. He's had rounds of 71, 73, and 72. Although he's had a share of birdies and bogeys, he's been tremendously consistent. The weight of the golfing world on his shoulders. To everybody else here, it would just be a great thing to win the Open. To Jack, he almost has to do it. Lewis going awfully fast. And you see, he's left himself that one for a birdie four. However, he should not have too much trouble getting a par five. What about Lee Trevino? Well, he is in what they would call position A. There are his rounds, 74, 72, 71. And of the top six or seven leaders, he's the only man who scored lower each day in the tournament. Despite the illness that has plagued him, remember, once again, he was in the hospital up in the Monday in El Paso. But I was talking to him just before he started playing with Nicklaus this morning. There's Blancas getting his par up on eight to remain plus two, one shot out of the lead behind Nicklaus and Zarley. But Lee was just as loose as he could be. He said, look, he said, I'm like a duck. I get up every morning, I see a brand new world. I don't know where I am or what happened yesterday. Just going to go out and explore it and see what's there. Well, found out there's a little more there than he thought there was. So Lee will have just as difficult a putt for a birdie as Jack Nicklaus will have. Again, up to the eighth, and Bill Fleming.
All right, this is a beautiful view of this 425-yard par four hole, a blind tee shot to the top of that cliff plateau, the second shot across the gaping oceanic chasm. And there you see Arnold Palmer out there in perfect position on the top of the plateau. He's shooting to a tiny green that's dwarfed by five large bunkers. Arnold only one stroke off the pace, has made a perfect tee shot, probably with a three or four wood. A placement shot, and here it comes over the chasm. Fine shot. It's just even to hit that green is something. He's on the green, and just look at the perils that this hole is fraught with. Here's Johnny Miller, who also has made a fine tee shot. This, remember, is a blind shot. You saw the golfers come off of seven down near the ocean. The tee for eight is right down next to the seventh green. Probably a five iron, perhaps a four iron to get across. And Miller's shot is on the green and in good shape. So both Miller and Palmer are on the green, will be putting for birdies at the eighth hole. Isn't that something? The first time ever that a United States Open championship has been played on a true seaside links course, and The golfers of America are getting a real treat. That's the way they stand, and it couldn't be any tighter. Imagine, nobody, now even par or under. Gives you an idea of the magnitude of this golf course. All right, back to Jim McKay and more action on Jack Nicklaus.
Okay, here's the man they call the Golden Bear. First heard of him when he was a student at Ohio State University, and he literally did burst on the golfing scene, won the United States Amateur in 1959. The next year, very nearly won the U.S. Open as an amateur. That hasn't been done since 1933, Johnny Goodman. Then Nicklaus came back and won the amateur again at Pebble Beach here in 1961. Turned pro and won the U.S. Open as his first professional victory in 62. You know pretty much of the story from there. This is for a birdie. It could put him in exclusive possession of the lead again. But that will be for his par five. You know, to see a tournament, a U.S. Open, which was won with a score of 290 or more, you have to go back to 1963 at the Country Club in Brookline, the triple tie with Julius Boros winning it from Jackie Cupid and Arnold Palmer. Seventh hole again now, and Frank Gifford.
And Kermit Zarley, who has a share of the lead. This is for a birdie from about 35 to 40 feet. Kermit Zarley has played every hole thus far in regulation today. And Zarley, coming close, will have this for his par three to remain locked in a tie with Jack Nicklaus. As we go quickly back to Jim McKay.
The sixth hole again, and Lee Trevino for his par five. Be a bogey six to put Lee Trevino at plus four, three shots behind the leaders, Jack Nicklaus and Kermit Zarley. He's having his problems. Back to Bill Fleming again.
And now Arnold Palmer on the eighth hole. Very happy to have six, seven, and almost eight behind him now, but he's safely on the green, which is a big accomplishment, but he's about as far away from that pin as you can possibly get. Somewhere around 40, maybe a little farther from the pin. The crowds here have been unprecedented, the largest attendance ever for a United States Open Championship. Even early in the week, they had more than 8,000 people out here just for practice rounds. This is for a birdie. If he makes it, he goes into a three-way tie for the lead with Nicklaus and Zarley. Wind, times, gusting up to 30 knots coming off Carmel Bay today. Huge waves out there, which has prevented any sailboats from being out. Here it comes. Looks awfully good, and it goes way by. Oh, as far as aim was concerned, it looked good. All right, Frank, back to you at 7.
Kermit Zarley picks up his par. He should. He has a putt of about 14 or 15 inches. And he did not. Lipping the cup is Kermit Zarley. He'll drop back to even par. I'll correct myself. He'll go back to two over par, Kermit Zarley. And he'll study this one. Wind, very deceiving. Byron Nelson, the wind has to bother the putting almost as much as the shots, wouldn't you say?
It bothers it more because you have to be so still on a putt to make these little putts on these extreme fast greens. It'll move you just any so small amount, and it can make you miss the putt like it did there.
Well, Kermit Zarley drops out of the lead. Jack Nicklaus now has sole possession of the lead at one over par. And here is, again, that beautiful shot of the seventh hole as we pan around to show you Carmel Bay moving back up to the tee. From the back of the tee, this hole plays 120 yards. It's playing, according to Creamy Caroline, one of the tour caddies, at just a little over 100 yards today. Jack Nicklaus, as Jim McKay mentioned a few moments ago, shooting for an unprecedented grand slam in golf. All the pressure on his back today.
Frank?
Yes, Byron.
So another thing that makes this whole place hard against the wind is you're shooting from a very high elevated tee. So it gives the wind more of a chance to get underneath the ball because the wind is coming up toward you from the green, coming off of Carmel Bay there. And if you hit the ball high at all, why, the wind has all this opportunity to do something with it when this green only is less than 2,000 square feet in, which is most unusual. So most of these players will just be playing kind of little chip shots almost down there with a straight-faced club.
All right, Jack Nicklaus. Sole possession of the lead at one over par. The pin way at the back of the green. A very narrow part of the green. It's on this way with a little punch. And it's left to the pin. It'll be perhaps 35 feet away, as you see, on the fringe on the left side. So Jack Nicklaus will have a considerable putt for a birdie here as we go now to Bill Fleming.
And you earlier saw Arnold Palmer on the eighth hole put his ball there, and this is the miss for a bogey five. Arnie now has dropped to plus three. He is two strokes off the pace. There it is again on the replay. Tough break for Arnold Palmer from Pebble Beach Golf Links in Pebble Beach, California. You're watching the U.S. Open Golf Championship, and we'll return in just a moment.
Back at Pebble Beach Golf Links, you're looking at the twosome of Jack Nicklaus and Lee Trevino. Lee Trevino hit to the golfer's right, as you see it, had to chip up. He's about 5 feet away for a par. This is Jack Nicklaus, just on the fringe, about 35 feet away. Nicklaus, sole possession of the lead at one over par. Kermit Czarly having just bogeyed here at seven. Kermit Czarly and Homero Blancas at two over par. But this is the man that holds all the golfing eyes of the world. This for a birdie. Jack Nicklaus with a two on seven. Now takes a two-shot lead. What a man. Oh, is he happy. And we've seen some spectacular play here on these par threes. As we'll be discussing a little later, this is Lee Trevino. He needs this for his par. He is four shots off the lead, four over par. So Lee Trevino saves his par at the par three seventh hole as we go now over to Bill Fleming on the eighth fairway.
And again, another look at this awesome hole, this eighth hole, where Kermit Czarly has made a fine placement shot from the tee, using a four wood to put it up on that plateau. But that's what he looks at, across to a green that is just absolutely dwarfed by the traps and the ocean and the immensity of the land here. Kermit, last 2 rounds, has used a 5-iron and has parred this hole all three previous rounds. And it bounces onto the green. A fine shot by Czarly, putting him in birdie position at 8. Beautiful shot after the bogey at 7. One of the most exciting things that can happen, of course, in a golf tournament, especially a championship, is to see a hole-in-one. It's even more remarkable to have tape rolling when it happens. Our cameras were on hole number 5 today when Bobby Mitchell was on the tee. He hit the shot, and up it comes. The last time there was a hole-in-one was yesterday when Jerry McGee did it on the same hole. But we had to wait 16 years because in 56, Bill Koontz did it at Oak Hills in Rochester, New York. 26,454 shots were played on par 3 holes before Jerry McGee yesterday. And wouldn't you believe, today, this ball comes right down and it will disappear right in the cup. It never bounced. It just dove in. And Bobby Mitchell had a hole in one. A remarkable circumstance, not only that he made it, but the fact that we happened to be there to see it. ABC Sports brings you the United States Open from Pebble Beach, California. Action continues right after this message. You know, golf has a new home in this country. The United States Golf Association has acquired a 50-year-old mansion to serve the dual role of a headquarters building and a public museum. This is Golf House on 62 beautifully landscaped acres in Far Hills, New Jersey. John Russell Pope, the architect who was responsible for many of the wonderful buildings in Washington, D.C., designed this Georgian-style building as well. Inside, the Bob Jones Room. The painting was commissioned by members of the Augusta National Golf Club, including President Eisenhower. And Calamity Jane, Bob's famous putter, hangs beneath the painting. The Golf House Library contains the most extensive collection of golf literature anywhere. The painting over the fireplace is Stewart's The First International Foursome. Golf House will be open on weekdays to receive visitors starting August the 1st. The USGA invites golfers to come and share the rich heritage of the game that we all love so much. Kermit Zarley, a birdie attempt on the eighth hole, slides to the right toward the ocean, as it always does here. And so he will mark, and this will be his putt for a par four. He is two strokes behind Jack Nicklaus, the leader. Bruce Crampton is three strokes behind, and Bruce is also on the green. So both he, Crampton, and Zarley will be putting for pars. It just can't get over the swing of 6, 7, and 8, and even 9 here. Any golfer who has ever played at Pebble Beach during the Crosby, or perhaps as an amateur when they had the championship here when Jack won it, knows exactly what faces the golfer, what test of courage it is. Bruce had a double bogey at the third hole today, or he'd be higher than he is at this point. Did go in. I thought for a moment it might not have been there. I think he can thank the wind a bit. So Bruce saved the par. There were three amateurs that made the cut, and Jimmy Simons wound up as the low amateur, just as he did a year ago at Marion. Tom Kite and Danny O'Neill, in his first open, was third low amateur. Now Kermit Zarley. This to save the par at 8. Uh-oh. Hit it too hard. So chalk up a bogey if he puts this one in. So that's little nippers there at 7 and also at 8. That's two bogeys in a row. So he goes to 3 if he makes this, which means that Homero Blancas now, and Arnold Palmer is 3 over. So Homero is the only one within 2. And there, as we go back, you get your last look at that chasm. Well, because Trevino and Nicklaus are the last group. Both tee shots, by the way, were beautifully placed. Trevino just a little bit shorter than Jack.
Bill?
Yes.
You know, it could be having some effect, more effect on Kermit than some of the other shorter players because this wind blowing a taller man make him move about more.
I know Jack said that it was the one time he wished he had more weight. Here's Trevino's second shot across the chasm on the green. Great shape below the hole on this 425-yard monster of a hole, the 8th. And now, Jack Nicklaus. I'm sure glad that, and hoping that this is the last time he has to play the 8th hole. Jack has played very steady. He's parred this hole all 3 rounds. Has admitted that this is the course that really requires thinking. Up he comes. It's on the green, hole high, but to the left of Trevino. Let's go to Henry Longhurst now at 10.
Now we see for the first time the farthest hole on the course, the 10th, two shotter, and his Homero Blancas playing extraordinarily well. And I have time to say while he readjusts himself that he started four over, he's now two over and out in 34. Well, that's a very fine shot. And the wind dead against. The night will be behind him as he plays back. He should get a four. That's Homero Blancas out in 34, gaining two strokes on par in the first nine. And that's the 10th hole, farthest distant on the course. And there's the way they stand. Jack Nicklaus even, two strokes ahead of Blancas, whom we've just watched, and three ahead of Zali, Palmer, and Crampton. Now we go back to the 8th and Bill Fleming.
And on the 8th hole, Trevino and Nicklaus are walking up, the gallery acknowledging them. The gallery actually has a beautiful spot here because they're elevated, looking down toward the green and toward the ocean. Beginning August 26th and continuing through September the 10th, ABC Sports will present the world's greatest sporting spectacle, the 20th Summer Olympics via satellite from Munich, West Germany. We'll feature unprecedented television coverage of international sports excitement. As you know, America's finest young athletes are now competing for a place in our Olympic team. But it does take a lot of money to put them in this world competition. Fortunately, every American can help out, and here's how you can do it. Send $5 to Olympic House, Box BA, 57 Park Avenue, New York, New York, and the zip code on that is 10016. In return, you'll receive a new colorful embroidered Olympic Games emblem for your jacket or your hat, and you can be proud that you helped send our team to the 1972 Olympic Games. Now Jack Nicklaus for a birdie. There has been a lot of talk, naturally, about this Grand Slam, but I think one of the most remarkable things about Jack is that in the two major tournaments so far, the Masters and the U.S. Open, he has led all four rounds in winning the Masters, has led or had a share of the lead all three rounds, and is leading now all alone in the U.S. Open. Those are his rounds, one under, and then as you saw, he had a 73, which was one over, and a 72 yesterday, and now this for a birdie. If he makes it, he would be the only man in the field to be under par. He right now is even. Very tough putt, and you saw Arnold Palmer earlier put that ball quite a considerable ways past. And it cost him a bogey. Jack spent a lot of time on the practice green this morning, especially with these longer putts. Oh, he hit it nicely, didn't he? Oh, that was really a splendid putt. Perfect for distance. Just a fraction off to the left side. That's for the par for Jack Nicklaus, remaining even. Well, here's our friend and wild hunter, Tommy Weisskopf, coming up from the chasm. Tommy had a 38 going out, had quite a few problems. But right now, on the 10th hole, he is down trying to get back into civilized country. Tom apparently caught part of that chasm. And beyond, of course, is the beach. And I can't tell whether he's in sand or where, but up on the 10th, rather on the 8th, Lee Trevino is putting for a birdie 3 on this par 4 hole. He strikes it very delicately, it looks like it, and then dives off toward the ocean. And he has the little 12-incher there for the par at 8. Lee is 4 over, started the day 1 over. And remains that way. And again, here comes Tommy, and he did not make it up. Weisskopf got about halfway up the hill, and the club head was stopped. Couldn't hit the ball solidly. And Tom, again, is struggling at 10. Henry, I believe you have a comment about that.
Well, I think this is a very, very fine two-shot hole. It's going to be more than two shots from Tom Weisskopf anyway. We might have a comment from Byron as to the difference this wind makes from yesterday. I think it must be a very long second shot.
Yes, Henry, I'm sure that most of the players, except some of the extreme hitters, will be using wooden clubs on their second shot here today, whereas yesterday, and especially the first two rounds from the wind the other direction, there were short shots. But down here in this country where Weisskopf is, this is real bad place. It's sandy, it's long grass. It's just very difficult to get onto the green. You see his shot as he's played there. I think he lies four from the information we get, putting for a bogey five.
So that's four for Weisskopf, and he's out in 38. He started four over par, now he's six over. Now here's the man with all the birdies to his credit, Mira Blancas. Only two behind the leader. He's got to be very careful with his putt or his little tiny chip back from the back of this green. Hit a very fine shot covering the flag all the way. It just went over. And with the unwatered greens, these are very tricky. They seem to stop by the hole and then run on and on and on. Homero Blancas. Well, that's done exactly what I suggested, and it's gone a long way by. Tom Weisskopf on the right, six over. And after his unseen adventures down on the beach there, we reckon he's played four. You have this one, a holdable one, for a bogey five. Just took it, and so it's a six for Tom Weisskopf. He goes from six over to eight over. But here's the man to watch, and this is for his par four, Homero Blancas. It's about 9 feet. His first one was the kind of shot we've seen a good many of today, and we'll see a lot more before we've finished. The one where the ball seems to gather speed and race past the hole. Score sheet, I think that Homero Blancas' 34 for the first nine is the best of the day. Now he has this for his par on the 10th. Now that was just blown away as well. So he drops a stroke. Homero Blancas goes to three over, three behind. And there's how they stand. Nicklaus, three ahead of the field. Johnny Miller, we see now, on the 10th, playing with Arnold Palmer. Miller, six over, starting two over. He had a wooden club, as Byron just predicted. And it's just short and on his left. And back down the fairway, we see Arnold Palmer just descending into the bunker on his left. Now, he seems to have quite a big iron. It's not a very deep face to the bunker, so maybe he's going to have a go in typical Palmer fashion. Well, he certainly moved it on out of that loose sand into some more loose sand. So from one lot to the other. Well, now from Pebble Beach, California, it's the U.S. Open. ABC's color coverage will continue after this message. Now we're back with Palmer. We saw him come from one loose sand into the next lot. It must have been a very fine shot out of the first bunker to get it into the second one here, level with the flag. Seems to be lying all right, and he's playing against this strong wind. Nearly. Now, he could have hoped for something rather better than that, I think. That's three over for Palmer. He doesn't look like getting one back here. May lose another. Now we go to Jim McCabe behind the 11th.
All right, Henry, coming up here is Homero Blancas, and take a moment to enjoy that view behind the waters of Carmel Bay. It must have been a view such as this that has attracted people all the way from Robert Louis Stevenson to Bing Crosby to, at one time or another, make their home here. But Homero Blancas is tied for second with Arnold Palmer and Bruce Cramp, and they're three shots behind Jack Nicklaus on this 380-yard par 4 hole. With the wind at his back, Homero had a real good tee shot, and he just has a lofted club to the green. The problem now, however, with the wind at his back is to keep it on the green once it hits there. It's a tendency to pick up some topspin and kick over. Well, he dropped it just short of the green and it bounced on, but he's left it too short. He'll be coming up at the flag. What do you think of that position on this hole, Byron? Now we're back to Arnold Palmer. Back on the 10th hole. Arnold, remember, has been in two bunkers already. He's waiting for them to rake the trap so that I guess his concentration will be total. You won't have to worry about that. Remember that when you're playing golf. If you don't have a caddy, be sure to rake it after yourself. Would you believe that the football season is starting? Well, it is on ABC next Saturday night. Coach's All-America game from Lubbock, Texas. Arnold Palmer now needing this for the par 4 on the 10th hole to remain at 3 over and in a tie for second place. Arnold has not won a major championship in 8 years. The last one he won, imagine, was the Masters Tournament in 1964. Won the Masters in 58, 60, 62, and 64. U.S. Open only once, 12 years ago in 1960 at Cherry Hills in Denver. He won the British Open the next 2 years, 61 and 62. Here he is with another try at age 42, but that's going to be a bogey. If he makes that, he will go to plus 4 and drop down into a tie with Lee Trevino and Kermit Zarley. Remember, again, it's Jack Nicklaus, three shots ahead as he starts out on this quest for the Grand Slam, the modern Grand Slam of golf that has never been achieved, the Masters, U.S. Open, British Open, and the PGA. Should he keep it going, we'll be going with him all the way to Muirfield, Scotland for the British Open, and to Oakland Hills in Birmingham, Michigan for the PGA Championship. We'll be going there anyway, whether he continues the quest or not, but sure may be exciting. Arnold Palmer now for the bogey 5. That's on the 10th hole. Now back up to 11, where we will be taking a look at Homero Blancas. You know, if somebody told you this morning that the man in a tie for second at this point in the afternoon would be a Texan of Mexican descent, you would not have said it would be Homero Blancas. You would have assumed, of course, it would be Lee Trevino, because Blancas was back at plus 4 when the day began.
Jim?
He got back to plus 2, and now he's at plus 3. Yes, Byron?
Well, you asked this question before.
About this putt, yeah.
Yes. Well,
the players definitely do not want to get above this hole because they're putting back downhill toward the ocean. It's very fast. And you see the caddy motion to him that ball is going to break to the right, but he's going uphill. And this is the thing they're trying not to do today, is to get above the hole because these greens are exceptionally fast.
Well, Bill was saying before that Jack Nicklaus said he wished he had a little more weight so he wouldn't blow over in the wind. Well, Homero does have a little more weight, so maybe he's a little more rock steady. Let's see. Slid by on the left, and he has left himself something he'll have to consider for the par four here. Tom Weisskopf, the playing partner, had trouble on that last hole, remember, took a double bogey, he's had trouble previous to that, and is at plus eight after starting the day at plus four. All the leaders yet have a long way to go, much of it into the teeth of this near gale force, at times wind of some 25 knots. You can see that Tommy's hair has been blowing a little bit as he moves around the course today. There's a feeling almost that this is a combination of the U.S. Open and the British Open because of the seaside nature of the course. And of course, the British Open, almost by regulation, must always be played on a seaside course. And here you have the wind also. It's a cool day, chilly. It's not summertime, even though the sun is out. And Tommy just can't get him rolling now. Once again, it's Nicklaus leading by three over Blancas, Crampton, and Palmer. But Blancas must now drop this in to stay. Here's Tommy Weisskopf looking to the heavens for some sort of consolation. Now Blancas needing this for the par. Homero does have a national championship in his career record. He won the Mexican Open in 1965. Aside from that, his most prominent title is the Colonial, down in Fort Worth. Okay, he's got it. Remains at plus three.
On this wide graphic illustration, the red or dark areas indicate where our cameras are placed on this most extensive coverage that any golf tournament has ever received. You noted that there by the arrow that we've already covered the short fifth and the sixth hole and the seventh hole, which is the little short 120-yarder. We've also seen shots across the yawning chasm on the eighth at par four. No coverage on nine, but from 10 on in, you'll be seeing everything. The 10th hole, a par four along Carmel Bay, will be covered by Henry Longhurst. I'll be reporting on 11, which is a par four up the hill, and also on the par three 12th hole. Bill Fleming will be placed behind the green on the par four 13th. It'll be Henry Longhurst once again on the longest hole in the golf course, the par 5, 14th. Bud Palmer and Dave Marr will be behind 15. On 16, it'll be Frank Gifford. And then on both 17 and 18, two of the most fascinating holes on the course, it will be Chris Schenkel and our expert commentator, Byron Nelson. Now, let's take a little more specific look at the coverage of these holes as we come on in. On the 10th, as we said, that's Henry's hole. It's on Carmel Bay. There is Pacific Ocean water on the right. And from the tee, you want to stay a little bit to the right just the same, because on the left there is more trouble for the unwary in the nature of these two bunkers. You see the birdies, pars, bogeys, double bogeys, and triple bogeys on the 10th hole of par 4. Now, I'm Jim McKay, and I'll be reporting behind the 11th. Out here, one of the idiosyncrasies of this golf course is that I'm as far from the clubhouse as you can get. In other words, on most modern courses, it's out and back for 9, out and back for 18. But here you go all the way out and all the way back. Well, the wind is blowing out here today, but it's at the golfer's back as he tees off on the 11th hole. This is a par 4, as I said, and the tee shot is uphill. They want to stay right in the middle because there's a bunker on the left, and there are trees and out of bounds on the right-hand side. There are also plenty of bunkers around the right-hand side of the green. Again, the birdies, pars, bogeys, and double bogeys on 11, a par 4 hole. The next, the 12th, I'll also be reporting on. This is a par 3, 205 yards in length. There is some out of bounds in those trees on the right. There is also, as you see, plenty of sand, both in front, on the right, and in back. Just about every place there is trouble here. Let's move on now to 13 and Bill Fleming.
Thank you, Jim. For the more superstitious golfers, number 13 has some rather frightening aspects to it. This is 400 yards long. It's a par 4, and it is all uphill from the teeing area back in a grove of trees. It possesses the longest bunker on the golf course on the left side of the fairway. This bunker is nearly 100 yards long. And any drive that happens to hook over there, of course, is caught in the sand. Up around the green, well bunkered again, and a very slick difficult green to putt. Let's go to Henry Longhurst at 14.
There are four holes of 500 yards or more on this Pebble Beach course, and this 14th is the longest of them. 555 yards and most of it uphill, and I don't think even with a little helping wind today, we shall see anybody reach it in two. You can see what a sharp dogleg there is and how easy you can get into either side bunkers. Then you can slice into somebody's garden all the way up on the right there, and you have a third shot which has to carry that very deep trap in front of the green there, and the flag is put up away on a little patch on the top left there. That's the 14th, so let's go out and see some action.
Here's Arnold Palmer hitting his second shot on the 11th hole, par 4. The way he's twisting, he wants it to do something, that old habit of his. And he has gone into the bunker on the golfer's left. So Palmer at plus 4 has three men ahead of him, Nicklaus, Blancas, and Crampton. Now Kermit Zarley with his third shot on the 10th fairway. So he's having problems again. Zarley, who is at plus 4, along with Palmer and Lee Trevino. Remember, Nicklaus leads by 3 over Homero Blancas and Bruce Crampton. By 4 over Palmer, Trevino, and Zarley. This is videotape of Homero Blancas' tee shot on the par 3 12th hole, 203 yards. And Homero hit a good one, but it went over, far over. Caught by a gust of wind, it looked like, and went way over in the back, so he's going to have a problem getting down in his par 3. Now, here's Arnold Palmer. This is live coverage again as he trudges up this 11th fairway up to the top of the hill with the wind at his back. How many fairways has this man trudged in the past 18 or 19 years? He won the United States Amateur Championship back in the mid-50s. Sometimes people forget that. He is a former U.S. Amateur Champion. And then kind of took over the Masters as his private fiefdom for a while, winning in 58, 60, 62, and 64. When he won the U.S. Open in 1960, he had the feeling that perhaps four or five more would come to him. None has, although during the 60s, he either finished second or tied for second on four occasions. And then there was the collapse, of course, in 1966 up the coast at Olympic when he led by 7 strokes over Billy Casper with 9 holes to play and lost them all and lost the playoff the next day. But remember the year that he won, he came from 7 shots back on the last round. Homero Blancas on the 12th hole, 1 hole ahead of Palmer and Johnny Miller. Homero is playing with Tommy Weisskopf, who really put his tee shot to the right on this hole. But Tommy's out of it now. He's played himself out as Homero's playing out of the sand. Must get this close in order to stay within 4 shots of Jack Nicklaus. Only Nicklaus at this moment is holding fast in his battle with par. And there was Palmer's trap shot on the right. There you see where Arnold's ball ended up. Homero coming up to that 12th green, and he didn't get there. Now, this is big trouble for Homero Blancas, a key point in his search for a U.S. Open championship here. Homero is always a man who has his ups and downs. Byron, you've seen so much of Homero ever since he was a kid down in Texas. It's always been kind of his pattern, hasn't it?
Yes, Homero can get the hottest on the golf course of anybody I've almost ever seen. And then he can do, as you see today and as he has done, his play in this tournament has been remarkable. He's been sensational and he's been just horrible. So
yeah.
This has been the way he plays. You can never tell, though, what he'll do.
That's right. Bruce Crampton on the 10th for a par. He needs this. And Crampton's going to drop back. What in the world? Now, Byron, what could happen there? Is this just a total loss of concentration, or is there a physical reason?
Well, yes.
He lies 3 now.
Jim, it is, but as we've talked about this rough, it's very tough, and the pin was close, so the long grass just caught his club and made him stub it.
Crampton now for a bogey back on the golf course. Everyone sliding and slipping and falling back except one man, Jack Nicklaus. Crampton now going to plus 4. And Blancas is going to go to worse than that. So Jack's going to have a 4-stroke lead here very shortly. When play on these various holes is completed. There's Kermit Zarley. He's dropping back. Just amazing that Nicklaus has been able to hold it to this point. Jack started out with a birdie on the second hole today. Then, however, he took bogeys at 4 and 5. Came back with a birdie at 7 to get even again. Now Homero Blancas with his 4th shot on the par 3 hole. That's got to be heartbreaking. You're playing for a dollar Nassau, but he's playing for the U.S. Open Championship. Now Palmer on 11. This for the par four, or else he's going to lose a shot. You don't attack this golf course. You try to defend yourself from it. What a good one. That was an old-fashioned Arnold Palmer charging putt, wasn't it? And a big one that keeps him just behind Jack Nicklaus as far as standings are concerned, in a tie for second place, but four shots behind him, along with Crampton, Trevino, Zarley. Zarley on the 10th hole. Remember, he's dropped quite a number of shots. He started off the day at plus one, but then he bogeyed 7, 8, and 9, all of them. And it looks like it'll be bogey here. We've just gotten word, look out, things may turn. Jack Nicklaus on the 10th hole has put his tee shot in the water of Carmel Bay. Stand by, it isn't over. Well, if that word were flashed, as it will not be, to these fellows up on the course, they might be a little less discouraged. Jack proving himself human after all. Homero Blancas got a double bogey. Azarli picks up another bogey. Homero got his five, in other words, and drops back again to five over. So Nicklaus at this moment, here's the way it is. Nicklaus has a four-shot lead over Bruce Crampton, Arnold Palmer, Lee Trevino, and Azarli. And here is here's the situation back on 10, where you see Jack Nicklaus. Arnold Palmer, meanwhile, teeing off on the par 3, 12th hole. And I think Arnold's going to consider that club again for a moment, maybe. Talking to an official. And there's Jack back on the 10th. The two great names of the decade. And looks like he's trying to get a ruling of some sort from P.J. Boatwright and Lynn Lardner of the USGA. Yeah, it's playing as a lateral hazard then. I think this is going to be it, Byron. Now back to Arnold Palmer, who's just below us.
Lateral hazard.
Right. Let's watch Palmer's tee shot here before we explain that lateral hazard further. Okay, Arnold is on there. He may be beginning to mount the final charge in the 1972 U.S. Open. Particularly since Jack Nicklaus is now having problems in a lateral water hazard. You have the right to drop it within two club lengths of the stakes defining the limits of the hazard under a penalty of one stroke. So Jack will be getting his third shot on a par four hole. Now, of course, he's even at the end of the previous hole. That score won't change till he concludes this hole. He's going to take a long walk up there, it looks like.
Jim.
There they are, again, visually. Nicklaus with a four-stroke lead at the moment, but probably only for the moment.
Jim.
For Arnold Palmer, Lee Trevino, Bruce Crampton, and then Zarley and Blancas. Yes, Byron?
Jack must hit a real bad drive because the wind is coming, well, it's against him, but also quartering in against him from the right there, so he must have hit a bad drive for Jack to push the ball down there, and he's way back there. He's going to have to go with a real big iron or possibly even a wood to try to reach this green if he does. Of course, you see what he's doing with the trying to figure out the wind, and he's really a long way back there. He's not even up, even those bunkers on the left, and this is most unusual for Jack to miss a tee shot this badly.
Did you notice, though, that there is a little part of the water that just nips in there by that stake, you know, and it kind of cuts almost into the fairway? So he could have gotten a bad kick on that tee shot and just caught that bit of bad luck. But this is one of the key moments in Jack Nicklaus's search for the Grand Slam. There are the waters of Carmel Bay. And you remember Weisskopf was down there. Look at the people strolling on the beach. Apparently there's somebody who doesn't care that Jack Nicklaus up here is in having terrible trouble. Oh, some people just have no idea. It was interesting. Just couples strolling on the beach. Like a scene from a movie. This, a scene from real stark reality. Now, here it is from the other angle. You see the water that he was down in there with it, the water and the cliffs kick in. Now, having taken his two club lengths and his one-shot penalty, Jack Nicklaus hits his third shot on this par four hole. A wide look at the situation. And here it comes. Did that go down? Oh, this is golf history right here. Jack Nicklaus has now put it down onto the beach. Whether he'll be able to play it or not, we don't know. He lies three already on the par five hole. Remember, he has a four-shot lead at the moment, but it is quickly disappearing. Arnold Palmer will soon have a putt for a birdie up on 12. Could it be that these two old and great adversaries, Palmer 10 years older than Nicklaus, will end up fighting it out? Now, there is Bruce Crampton, who doesn't know anything about what's going on with Nicklaus, neither does Arnold Palmer. Bruce Crampton, very much in it. He is at plus four. Remember, he's tied with Arnold Palmer and with Lee Trevino. Trevino, playing with Nicklaus, by the way, does know what's going on. And Lee's a guy who likes to know what's going on. There's Lee, looking on, having witnessed the disaster that has come to Jack Nicklaus, at least temporary disaster. So, Lee was very confident on the practice putting green this morning, and even though he's had his troubles, he is still in it.
Jim,
Is that Dave Marr out there?
Certainly is.
You're walking the fairways, aren't you?
No, I'm up on 15.
Oh, you're back on your tower now.
Right.
Okay, yes, Dave.
But I think Lee knows that he might be able to pick up three shots here if he can make a birdie, which would be a tremendous birdie.
Sure could. He's hitting that one left. Oh, he just got over it. You know, what's strange here, Dave, is that I guess Byron indicated this. The wind is coming off the sea as well as against them, and yet they're going to the right, where they shouldn't be.
Well, it swirls around, and Jack's ball down there, the marshal found it sort of fast, so maybe he'll be able to play that. That's not watered
yeah, it looked
down,
like it
though
might,
he's still in the hazard.
Looks like it's hung up in that long grass.
Jim?
Yes, Byron?
I've been down that bank there.
Oh, you never went down in a place like
most
that.
Most of the time you can plow there, unless you're unfortunate, because it's a long ways from there on down to the beach. So Jack may have some sort of a shot left. However, it will not be good regardless.
Now, Arnold Palmer is preparing for his attempt at a birdie on the 12th. If he would get a birdie, let's see, Jack lies three. The best he can hope for is a bogey. Suppose he takes double bogey. Yeah, Arnold Palmer could gain three shots very easily. Lee Trevino will not likely do that now, but could. Arnold Palmer at the moment, tie, remember, with Trevino and Bruce Crampton, but if he would make this long putt, he would take sole possession of second place and would inch closer to Jack Nicklaus. You don't often see the man from Columbus in a place like this. Nicklaus on the rocks, Palmer on the putting surface. It seems to be getting colder. Nope. We'll need that for par three. This great feeling of a combination, I think I started to say before, the U.S. Open and the British Open here, because of this seaside feeling, and that shot of Jack walking in those high weeds looks like something you'd see at Muirfield in Scotland or St. Andrews. Okay, that's the par three for Palmer. Keeps him at plus four. Meanwhile, back at the Nicklaus Ranch, that's what it looks like, doesn't it? He lies three. His tee shot went in the water. You see the problem he is presented with on this steep bank. But Dave, did you find any of that this week?
I found every bit of trouble there was here, James.
Close attention to this. Brian, the ball's going to run pretty good coming out of there, isn't it?
Yes, it really will, because, and also the wind is blowing with him.
Yeah. Well, he got it up. Now lies four, not that far away from the pin, so he's got a chance at a bogey five. This now is Bruce Crampton on the 12th hole. He was bunkered. Excuse me, Bruce on 11th hole, if I said 12. Bruce playing with Kermit Zarley. Now lies three, and he has the potential for a bogey here, fighting again to hold on to the par. But Nicklaus, remember, held steady through the front nine, going an even par 36, but came to the 10th. Now, at the 13th, Bill Fleming.
And Arnold Palmer is teeing off on the 13th, 400 yards, par four. And I'm sure by now the word, which travels quickly here, has come to Arnold that Jack is in trouble. And he's caught the rough on the golfer's right. That's not too good a place to be. And so far, the golf course has brought the golfers to its knees. Jim?
Lee Trevino on the 10th hole for a birdie three. Well, where's the hole? There it is. Wow, Lee really left that one short. Lee's concentration doesn't seem to be quite as total today with these bogeys he's been picking up here and there. His putter has been very faithful to him all through the tournament. In fact, he said, this is what's been carrying me through. He said, on my tee shots, he said, I got no strength in my legs. I'm just kind of trying to slice the ball out into the fairway. Those are Lee's words. His tee shots didn't look that bad to us.
Well,
now the putter deserting him a little bit. Yes, Byron?
It does take a lot. It takes much more strength to play on a day like today, and the strength, he could feel this weakness in his legs, and this, when you feel weak in your legs, believe it or not, it affects your putting almost more than it does the rest of your game because you do not feel steady, and especially when the wind's blowing strong like it is today.
Okay, well, now we're so used to talking about people going for birdies on these golf telecasts. Well, here you have Bruce Crampton on the right needing that for a par, and Jack Nicklaus on the left needing that for a bogey. Jack lying four already on the par four hole. Now, Bruce made a good attempt, but he's going to take a bogey five here and drop five over par. Nicklaus for the bogey that would put him at plus one. Big putt here. Crampton got the bogey all right. And it's going to be a double bogey six for Jack Nicklaus. Puts him at two over par, and now he leads by only two over Arnold Palmer and Lee Trevino. And think of this, with all the shots that have been played in this tournament all week long to this point, suddenly, with a few holes left, the men fighting it out are Jack Nicklaus, Arnold Palmer, and Lee Trevino. But Trevino needs this for his par, or else he's going to lose one. Lead is only two. Remember that. It looked like Jack was going to run away with it. He can't do that now. And Lee Trevino takes a bogey I have never seen so many in a major championship. And that puts Trevino at plus five. And that means that the only man two shots behind Jack Nicklaus is Arnold Palmer. There is the leaderboard. Nicklaus two ahead of Palmer, three ahead of Lee Trevino, Bruce Crampton, Kermit Zarley, and Homero Blancas. Nicklaus, however, still with eight more holes to play. Let's go up course now to Bill Fleming.
All right, Jim, that was a very historic moment you described because it was the first double bogey in the entire tournament for Jack Nicklaus. And now Arnold Palmer, the man who is closest to that goal, is in the rough on the golfer's right. And there you see a pretty good view of this hole. Not a very pretty hole, actually, as far as beauty is concerned. Very tough hole to get that ball up out of the rough and then stop it on this lightning-fast green. Green canted toward the ocean, bakes in the sun, is whipped by the wind. Arnie has 160 yards into the hole.
Bill?
Go ahead, Dave.
Everything depends on the sort of lie he has there. He's in the deepest part of the rough, and you can see he's walking around studying it pretty well. He's... be pretty lucky to get it on the green if it's very deep right there, which it looks to be.
Right, and the pin is in the first third of the green, so he doesn't have much to work with. If he should bounce it in front, it would be his only chance. If he's long, it could go clean over.
It'll bounce left on him, won't it?
Definitely. All of them seem to run right toward water. So this is a critical shot with Arnold Palmer within two strokes of the lead, but if this one isn't perfect, it comes up short. He played it well. It's short of the green, but you may even see him putt it from there. Jim?
All right, we now have Jack Nicklaus on the 11th tee, a par 4 hole, 380 yards. He's driving uphill, but a tremendous wind is right at his back as he addresses the ball. He could come a long way up here. Let's see. Try to spot the ball as it flies up towards the fairway. And he's on the left-hand side, but he's okay. He is on the fairway on the left-hand side. Jack Nicklaus on the fairway on the 11th hole. You're watching the climactic final round of the most famous golf tournament in the world, the U.S. Open. We'll return in a minute.
Just moments ago, Arnold Palmer hit that shot on the 13th hole, and you see the dismay that he had. Had that gone in, he would have been only one stroke behind. Jim?
We're on 11 now. We'll be in a moment here. And there we are. Lee Trevino and Jack Nicklaus. Their tee shots were very similar, very close together. And it looks like Lee is going to hit first. But just about.
For a man with tired legs, Jim, he hit the ball pretty far, didn't he?
Boy, he sure did. This second shot with the lofted iron. And again, remember, he's got to land on the front because with the wind at his back, it's probably going to roll when it hits the putting surface. Shouldn't bite too much. It's a little to the right, yeah, right-hand side of the green, and there it goes, off the back, you see. Happens so often. Just into that longish stuff there. Again, Nicklaus leads Arnold Palmer by 2 and Lee Trevino by 3, and tied with Trevino also are Crampton, Zarley, and Blancas. That's the way it is. Jack Nicklaus in back of him, the waters of Carmel Bay. There you see Jack's round today with birdies, pars, bogeys, and the one double bogey, his first of the championship. Is that a lovely sight? Whew. One of the most beautiful golf courses in all the world. Has to be. One of the toughest. The way things are going, they may have to say at the end, and the winner is Pebble Beach Golf Course. Now, he played it short, but it stayed too short. That seems to be the pattern of this hole today. If you put it in the fringe in front, it pulls up too fast. Now to Bill Fleming.
All right, this little 8-inch putt here for the par. Arnie came so close on the approach to making the birdie, but he still is only 2 strokes behind, and look out. Jim?
Bruce Crampton in trouble in the bunker on 12. Remember, Bruce is 3 shots back, tied for third with Lee Trevino. This is the par 3 hole, and he has left himself that putt for the par 3, so he could take another bogey here. Bruce Crampton of Australia. He's won $100,000 in each of the last 4 years. One of the most consistent players on the tour, but he's never won any of the national championships except his own Australian Open, which he won as a 20-year-old 16 years ago. Trudging up to the 11th green are Jack Nicklaus and Lee Trevino. And Trevino, guess what, is talking. No matter how tight it is, no matter how tough it is, somehow the happy chap from Texas finds it possible to joke and talk and vocalize his feelings. He was feeling better, by the way. You know that he was in the hospital last Monday and so forth. In the first couple of days here, he was coughing his way around. He could hardly make himself heard, but he was still trying to talk. But when I was talking to him this morning, just before they began, his voice sounds a lot better. And he says he feels good, but he still feels a little bit, he said, like the airplane's still coming down. He said, that's the way I feel. A little light in the head and the ears. And he's still gulping the pills that were prescribed for him by the physicians back in Texas, who really didn't want him to leave the hospital. They said, you know, you might have a relapse. You might get real sick. He said, then again, I might get well. So he came to defend his championship. Kermit Zarley on the right there is up on 12, and he's putting for a par. Lee Trevino is putting, or chipping, for a birdie. He's got a lofted club back there out of this long stuff, coming downhill pretty fast. It's a good shot. But look at it keep going. See that? Just going and going and going. Those lightning fast greens. Let's see what Zarley can do with the par putt on 12. Lee's going to have a tough one again for the par. There's something blowing back there. canvas and pipes blowing around. All right, Kermit. Well, he didn't do it. It's another bogey for Kermit Zarley that drops him to 6 over, and he started the day at 1 over. But it's happening to everybody. And is even happening now to Jack Nicklaus, who had been steady through 9, but then, remember, took a double bogey 6 on the 10th hole. And here is Jack with this putt for a birdie on the 11th hole, a birdie that could bring him back to 1 over par. I said before that no U.S. Open has been won with a score of 290 or more since 1963 at the Country Club in Brookline, Mass., and that was a triple tie among Boros, Cupid, and Palmer. And before that, you have to go all the way back to 1935 at Oakmont in Pittsburgh to find a score of 290 or better to win the Open. Well, it could happen today. We'll be at Oakmont next year for the Open, by the way. It's a good putt. Jack was happy with it, but it just didn't quite go in. In fact, if Jack pars in from here, he will have exactly 290 for his total. Dave, you were saying something to me a while ago. I think that Jack must play himself from here on in.
Well,
Interesting thought.
Well, I think with a two-shot lead there, that's...
Now, let's see what this is. Excuse me, Dave, but we got something up on 12 here with Crampton. I don't know what sort of a ruling he had asked for.
Well, it could be two things, Jim, the ruling there. Now, you see Trevino getting ready to make his attempt at a par at the 11th hole.
Right.
Well, it could either be that's a bogey 5 for Lee. It could be an old cup, which has to be fixed by the officials. Or it could be, you know, is this a ball mark? He might ask someone, and then they would come over and look at it. So he would be entitled to fix the ball mark, or they would repair an old cup.
Yeah, in other words, a cleat mark you cannot fix. A ball mark you can. So they might have to say which it was.
You better not fix any cleat marks.
That's right. Well, now here's Nicklaus needing this for a par. He's 2 shots ahead of Arnold Palmer, but he could gain another shot on Lee Trevino. There is, on the right, Crampton for his par up ahead. Both putting for pars and fighting for them. Jack gets his. Bruce gets his. So it's Nicklaus, 2 ahead of Palmer, 3 ahead of Crampton and Blancas, 4 ahead of Trevino. Up the course now to 14, and Henry Longhurst.
Now we look down on the 14th fairway. This is the very long hole. Palmer has safely got round the corner. Considerable dogleg to the right. He's in exactly the right place. Whether he's waiting for Blancas to finish out putting, I'm not sure. Now he's going to play safely up with an iron. Wind behind. That hasn't moved on as far as I should have thought or that he would have liked. And he's left himself at least 100 yards. Looking down on the green, he's Blancas, who will get a safe par with that little putt. Blancas, 5 over. The best outward half on our board so far, out in 34. Now back to Jim McCann, 12.
Where Jack Nicklaus will approach this par 3 hole. It's a 205-yard hole. To carry the trap in front of the green is a 194-yard shot. Nicklaus will be hitting first and Trevino second. Jack with a 2-stroke lead over Arnold Palmer, who you just saw up the course. Homero Blancas is another stroke further back along with Bruce Crampton. The wind is blowing from left to right. Jack looking up. Now, he's looking straight up, Dave. You think, what was he looking for? To see how the clouds are going, something like that?
Well, you look at the tops of the trees to see, to try to gauge just how hard it is blowing, you know. And this is a shallow green to hit into. So he's looking up again.
Yeah.
And hard to say what club Jack might be using.
If I had to guess.
3 or 4, something
looks
like that.
Looks like a 4, if I had to guess. He's right below us here.
like it, if it's not too long. But it is long, and look at that. Way down.
And
it's
look
just
where
what happened to
Blancas
at worse, yeah. Look at that. You can't even see the ball.
It
Nicholas with a two-shot lead has trouble again. $200,000 in prize money and the most important championship of them all are at stake here at Pebble Beach, and we'll return to the action after this message. Here we are back at Pebble Beach, an airplane cruising overhead, and Jack Nicklaus walking to his ball, which is behind the 12th green. Jack Nicklaus leads by two shots over Arnold Palmer, but that lead may not last too long. Watch it now as he surveys it. There you see the edge of the putting surface right where he's standing. Look how far down he's going to have to come, and look what he's going to have to come into. Could be they might need a ruling here. The ball may be in a hole. There are a lot of gopher holes on this golf course, and if you get in a hole made by a burrowing animal, is the way it's phrased in the rules of golf, you do get a drop, so... See, he's coming straight up at the pin, but
Jim,
it's a very delicate shot. Yes, Byron.
You see him talking to the caddy and the man up there at the green. Jack was very disappointed in his shot. You know, he's been talking about and looking at the green there, which meant that he thought that he'd see him kind of shook his head. He thought for sure that he'd played a shot that would hold the green. And when it did not, why, he was very disappointed about it and almost to the point of being nearly upset about it.
Okay, remember, he leads Arnold Palmer by two shots, and while we were away, Arnold hit a shot to the 14th, which is a par 5. This is his third shot on the par 5 hole, and watch it. This happened a few moments ago, remember. Lovely shot, and look at the draw on it. Arnold's going to have that putt for a potential birdie, and here is Nicklaus in trouble. Nicklaus only on the 12th. After this, has six long ones to slog his way through, and when they get to 17 and 18... you are going to see some of the tensest golf there's ever been in the U.S. Open. 17 into the teeth of the wind at par 3 with the rocks below, and 18 along the rocks on the left-hand side all the way. Well, this one doesn't look that prepossessing, but it's plenty of trouble for Jack right now. And there was no free drop or anything. He's playing it as it lies, according to the rules of golf. Oh, and just like Homero, he didn't get up. He did not get up. He can not only lose one, he could potentially lose two more here.
Jim, you remember a while ago, Homero Blanco was almost in that same rough and hit it and it didn't get out. And we felt he kind of stubbed it. Well, you saw he hit it. That rough there is so tough. And the rough is kind of laying down towards you. In other words, kind of against the grain. And if your club hits it, it just really stops the club.
Here is Lee Trevino on the same hole playing with Jack Nicklaus. And his bunkered shot is struck beautifully. Look at that. Again, that's no automatic three, but it's got a good pop at it anyway, after bogeying the last two holes. In slow motion, we're going to take a look now here, Byron, at Jack's tee shot.
All right. Jack has been swinging so well, of course, for a number of years, and watch how he keeps the club way, very full extension. He's come way up high and leading here and hit down. It appears there that he did not get quite as much divot as he normally does, hit the ball quite clean, and this maybe is the reason why, as you see the ball, why it did not hold in and went over the green so fast.
It really looked like it had a lot of topspin on it, didn't it? Well, now, Jack lying two has this one. If you remember, Homero Blancas got this far in two and then stubbed it again and lay three and was still in that stuff. It might be encouraging to those of you who are golfers that that long grass, when it's lying against you like that, isn't easy for them either. Now, here is Arnold Palmer on the right of your screen going for a birdie. Jack Nicklaus having to hold that shot for a par. They could end up tie after this hole very easily, depending on what happens, always. Palmer for the bird on the right. They're going to hit almost simultaneously. Nicklaus having to hole out once again for a par here. There goes Arnie. Well, Arnie missed his. And Jack has put his way past, still running. Arnold should get a par 5 here. Jack is fighting for a bogey 4. If he gets the double bogey, let's watch Arnold now. For the par. Okay, he has the par. If Jack Nicklaus misses this one, he's in a tie with Arnold Palmer for the U.S. Open Championship. Wow. Arnie, remember, 8 years since his last major win.
12 years since winning the Open. Jack won the Open 5 years ago. Last year he lost it in a playoff. This year he's already won the Masters. If he can hold on and win this, many people think he can win the Grand Slam as Arnie trudges off to the next tee. Dave, what do you think about this putt?
Well, he's got a lot of things running through his mind now. I mean, he's already made his first double bogey at 10, and he's got another one staring him in the face here at 12, Jim. He's got to get his balance back a little bit. The putt is going to be very fast and should break, I think, a little bit right to left. And if he ever needed to make one, it's right here.
You ever remember as many double and triple bogeys in the Open as we've had this year?
No, and I made a few of them myself.
Boy, they're all getting them. The wind is whipping the canvas up here on our tower. Now, on the right, we now present Mr. Bruce Crampton, who has a putt for a birdie. Should Crampton make his birdie, that would bring him back to +4 and get him into the thick of things with Arnold Palmer and Nicklaus. Blancas isn't out of it yet. You can't really say Trevino and Zarley are. Well, that's for the bogey. And what a big putt that was for Jack Nicklaus. A big putt for Jack Nicklaus.
That kind of putt takes a tremendous amount of courage, Jim.
Jack is at +3. He's one shot ahead of Arnold Palmer. Let's see what Crampton does here. This for the birdie. Starting it very, very slowly. You see why. It just keeps going by. So Crampton will have that for par to remain at +5, two shots behind the leader. It's all going to be decided in the last few holes. You can forget just about everything that's happened up to here. Here's Lee Trevino for the par on the 12th hole. Trevino, who is at +6, he's only three shots behind Nicklaus, remember that. And he's playing him head-to-head, as he did in the playoff for the championship last year. And of course, Lee won, and he gets the par. Real important putts there for both Jack Nicklaus and Lee Trevino as they move off the 12th green, on to 13. And Bruce Crampton needing this for the par. Remember, after they get through 13 and 14 and 15, then they turn back for the sea again. When they get to 17, they'll be staring out at the waters of the Pacific. It appears almost certain now that this Open will be won with a score of 290 or more. Byron, isn't that what you said in our preview about a week ago?
Yes, I didn't think that they'd burn the place up, and they certainly haven't.
You could hardly say that. In fact, they're kind of freezing it out right now. Bruce Crampton remains at +5. He's two shots behind Nicklaus. It's Nicklaus by one over Palmer, two over Blancas and Crampton, and let's go to Bill Fleming.
All right, and Lee Trevino is on this 13th tee, 400 yards, in a little grove of trees, well shaded and shielded from the wind. But the minute that ball squirts out of there, the wind will start to work on it. And he doesn't like it at all. Way to the left, over in that big bunker that we talked about earlier that runs almost 100 yards long. You can see it there in the sand. So any errant ball is sure to be caught on the left side. Jack really needs a placement shot here. The fairway itself is only 37 yards wide in the target area. And it wouldn't surprise me to see him use a three-wood. You might want to comment on that, Dave, or Byron.
I think he'd be going with a driver because he didn't realize now that he'd like to have a birdie. Looks like a driver to me.
That's his driver.
Okay. He hit it. He hit it. On the left side, and I don't know where theirs goes down, and the spectator apparently was hit by the ball as he hit it. I don't even know if the ball has stopped yet.
Bill, so it has stopped in the middle of the road there. It hit the lady on the foot. She didn't see it coming. But one thing, you must play off the road in the tournament. He's not going to get a drop from there, so he's going to have a shot that I'm sure he doesn't practice too often.
Okay, while we were on this, Arnold Palmer had his problems. Bud Palmer?
He sure did. Arnold right here has probably hit some trees coming through. It's a rather narrow opening of about 30 yards, and watch his reaction. And there it goes into the trees. And there's where it landed, a long, long way from home, right, Dave?
Yeah, the grass there, it's a little bit sandy, actually. And you could see, I think his foot slipped, or those of us that might be a little meaner might have said his heart slipped. But it's a little hard to get firm footing there. He's pretty lucky to get through as far as he did, but he didn't drop down into that hazard just off the tee.
Yeah, but he sure has a long ways to go. He came way up forward to find out exactly how far it was, trying to measure it off. And here's the man who's trailing now just by one shot. He's in second place, and a man who has finished second in the Open four times has only won it once, and that in 1960. He's only one shot off the lead, and this has certainly taken the players. In fact, this second nine is so difficult that in the first two rounds, if you can believe this, the players here at the Open took 527 more strokes to play the back nine than the front nine, and they're both 36-36. That's some switch, isn't it, Dave?
Certainly is. That's an awful lot of strokes. Difference.
Here's
I don't know whether he can get to the green with the club he's got.
He is in three previous rounds, had a 4, a 5, and a 4. This is his 19th Open. He said his 68 here, the second round is probably the best competitive round of his year. And better, and he shot a 65, which won it in 1960 at the Open. Arnold Palmer just one shot off the lead here, the 406-yard par 4, the 15th. Here it comes. He's hooked it. It's going to go into the crowd, and maybe it comes down. No, kicks into the rough. He's given himself about, I'd say that's about 65 yards away from the green. This is the shot he has now. He has to come over a little bit, just the corner of that bunker on the left. And now, Bill Fleming, you got a heap of problems there, as we can see. What's going on?
Well, my problems aren't nearly as bad as Lee Trevino's and Jack Nicklaus's. Lee is about 165 yards from the flag in that big bunker, and he sends it to the right. And this may go into the rough, and it does stay in the high grass. You know, this golf course is such a beautiful thing. It's almost like a lovely lady who's been smiling all week long, and now all of a sudden it's developed into an old hag who's cackling and enjoying this moment of watching these golfers in ultimate frustration. Jack took a long time to come off that tee. Normally he walks very briskly, but Lee was a good 150 yards ahead of him, and now Jack is just coming up to that point. His ball, incidentally, is right in the middle of the road, 145 yards from the flag stick.
Bill?
Yes, Byron?
If his ball had not hit that lady on the foot, it would have gone clear across that road into the bunker that's guarding the ninth fairway there.
I don't know which would have been worse.
Well, the road would be easier than the bunker would, because these bunkers are very difficult.
Well, here's, Byron, it appears to me as if the only really shot he has is just to try to bounce it up maybe 15 or 20 feet in front of the green and just try to hope that it will roll true to the flag, because there will be certainly no way to stop the ball, I wouldn't think. Hitting it off plate glass like that.
Well, if you catch the ball exactly right off a hard turf, you can stop it. But if you were to hit a little bit behind it, then it will throw the ball, and you're exactly right. It would run very, very fast. So
right, that's just
at the best, he has a very difficult shot.
It's just a dirt road. It's been used and ground down by the spectators during the course of this Open, of course. Lee Trevino is up 60 or 70 yards short of the green in the rough, and Jack is getting ready for his second shot. Jack has lost three strokes to par in the last three holes, a double bogey at 10 and a bogey that you just saw at 12. And this is a critical shot because he only has a one-shot lead on Arnold Palmer, but Arnie, as we talked about it, Bud, is in the high grass there.
He sure is. Billy's about, I said 60 yards, about 50 yards from the pin, and it's real deep down there, isn't it, Dave?
Yeah, but he looks like he's got a pretty good lie. You could see it in your set there, and he's actually chipping uphill. It's not, if you missed it, that's the place to be, to the left side of the green here, because it'll be a little slower. He can have a little more control on this chip.
This is his third shot on the par 4 15th. One shot off the lead. About 18 feet. Bill Fleming?
All right, and here's Jack playing off the little roadway. He has a perfectly open shot. He sends it up good and high. It may be a dandy. It comes up and will be on the putting surface, and what a shot! It actually had some bite on it, as you suggested, Byron. He is hole high, and a good chance at a birdie. ABC Sports exclusive color coverage of the United States Open from Pebble Beach, California, will continue in a moment. Lee Trevino in the high grass, his third shot. And look at this. Talk about touch and finesse. The ball hits and curls right in toward the cup. Absolutely a beautiful shot, and still leaves him in position for his par putt. Now let's go to 15.
Well, on 15 here, we left Arnold Palmer with about an 18-foot downhill putt. He went for it boldly, just slipped by. He has this for his bogey right now. That'll put him two strokes off the pace. Jack Nicklaus later. He has the bogey. And that puts him five over in a tie with Romero Brankus and Bruce Crampton for second place. Jack Nicklaus is three over. Tough break for Arnold on that drive, but as Dave said, he might have slipped a little bit. Bill Fleming?
All right, this is a huge putt for Jack. Jack trying for his 13th major title, which would tie him with Bob Jones. He has a two-stroke lead over Arnold Palmer. If he makes this, it could be three strokes. Jack really had a shot that will long be remembered when he hit it off that roadway after hooking his drive horribly off the tee here. Now Jack, while he's getting ready, take a look at it again. Look at this. Hit it right off that hard road, and up it comes, and look at the action on the ball. That's what's amazing. And it stopped hole high. He taps it in for the par. He saved it. Yes, he saved it. Can't be too disappointed after the start. Now Lee Trevino, just to save his par after a truly great shot. Lee hasn't seen fairway on this hole. He was in the bunker on the left and the rough on the right. Now he's on the green. This is for the par, and not an easy putt at all. The golfers will tell you that the 13th hole putts harder than any hole in the golf course. This will have a huge break towards the ocean, toward his left. And it didn't get it. Now let's go to Frank Gifford.
And the tee shot of Arnold Palmer at 16. You must place the ball well. Slight dog leg to the right, not long, 400 yards. Meanwhile, Trevino has bogeyed 15, and Palmer is in the rough on the right. He will have a line of sight to the pin, and this is Romero Blancas. This is for a four. Trickling by, so Romero, who is a five over par, will have this for a bogey to go six over par. Romero hit his second shot into the bunker that is in the front of the green here at 16. Blasted out. This again for a bogey. So Romero Blancas is six over par. And the final round of the U.S. Open Golf Championship from Pebble Beach, California, continues in a moment. Arnold Palmer, just off the fairway in the rough at 16, is perhaps checking a marker that he is using for distance. We would estimate he is about 155 to 160 yards out. And again, his problems, Dave Marr, will be how deep in that rough he really is.
Because it will affect exactly what the ball does, you know, getting out of there, plus what it does when it hits the green.
Meanwhile, we will take a look at Jack Nicklaus's drive on 14, Dave.
That looks a little better swing than he made at 13.
He nevertheless has caught the rough. As
as the crowd, and what a crowd it is on a beautiful day, on a beautiful golf course that has really turned treacherous this afternoon. Now, looking up the fairway, over the green of 16, Arnold Palmer has about 155 to 160 yards. He can see the pin. The trouble is on the left. There is even out of bounds on the left. A lot of trees. And he has it moving off to the right. And he may go over the green. He does. And just stops short of the bunker. He'll have a very difficult stance to coming back. A very difficult shot for Arnold Palmer. Wow, and what kind of play we've seen here today.
He might have been a little better off, Frank, if he was in the trap there.
We'll look at the 14th hole and Henry Longhurst.
And there's where Trevino and Nicklaus are at the 14th. Nicklaus, that's Trevino there, and Nicklaus in the right. And he will be obstructed by a very big fir tree, which stands 95 yards short of the green. I had hoped that he might hit a huge drive here and see if we get on in two, but still, we go to Jim McKay.
U.S. Open is really only the beginning of a tremendously exciting summer for those of us at ABC Sports, and we certainly hope for you at home, too. It's going to be climaxed at the end of August and the beginning of September by the Summer Olympic Games in Munich, West Germany. They truly should be magnificent. I think the most exciting Olympics that have ever been held. We'll be there for 16 days of coverage, including 3 hours every weekday night, the entire evening schedule of ABC television, and even more on the weekends. That's the Summer Olympics, so really put down a very strong note for yourself on that one. And before the games themselves, we'll be bringing you the Olympic trials as the summer wears on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Olympic trials in boxing, in gymnastics, in swimming and diving, and of course, in track and field. In golf, well, as we said, this is only the beginning in that sport, too, because the British Open is coming. Perhaps still Jack Nicklaus will be making his effort at the Grand Slam, but even if he isn't, it should really be something. Played at the glorious old course at Muir Field, Scotland, and ABC Sports will be there. We'll also be at the PGA Championship in Birmingham, Michigan, at Oakland Hills. That will be the first week in August. Believe it or not, football starts on ABC next Saturday night. That's right. This Saturday night, the Coaches All-America game from Texas, live. Then there will be the College All-Star game, the last weekend in July, the last Friday night, in fact, with the College All-Stars going against the world champion Dallas Cowboys. And the next day, the Pro Football Hall of Fame game from Canton, Ohio, with the New York Giants against the Kansas City Chiefs. I hope you absorbed all that. Let's get back to the golf.
Now down the fairway at the 14th, longest hole on the course. Lee Trevino. A remarkable physical feat, I'm sure you'll agree, to finish at all. Anybody who's lived on antibiotics for a few days knows the feeling. Now we go to 16 and Frank Gifford.
Thank you, Henry. And this is the problem of Arnold Palmer. As we speak softly, Arnold Palmer right below us, he will be able to, I think, stand out of the bunker. It's going to be very close, as you see. There is the ball. He has to come up about 15 feet, and he'll have a difficult time stopping the ball. The grain and the slope of the green will both work away as Arnold Palmer hits his third shot here at 16, trailing Jack Nicklaus by two shots. Very difficult, Dave Marr, this stance.
Well, he's, got no stance, really, but I think he's trying to see what is under the ball exactly, because he's got to try to hit just as soft a shot as he can. As you pointed out, he's going straight downhill and down grain. There's almost no way to get it close.
A difficult golf course. Jack Nicklaus found the abalones and the lobsters on 10. A few minutes ago, Tony Jacklin was putting out. A deer burst out of the woods, ran across just short of the green.
Even the deer couldn't get on the green, right?
This is the third shot for Arnold Palmer here at 16. That will go well by, but a fine shot considering the circumstances. Trickling across the green just off the fringe, but as you can see, sitting up. As we go quickly now to Henry Longhurst.
And we're back to the 14th Bruce Crampton sizing up a putt for his par five. They've taken a long time at this hole because Colonel Zali went over the green and various adventures there. Now this one will be for Crampton to stay within two shots of the leader. They're more than a couple of feet, but a very tricky green. Ah, dear. Well, we'll go to Frank Gifford now.
Where Arnold Palmer is in danger of also losing a shot to Jack Nicklaus. He has hit his third shot, as you saw a few moments ago, across the green. He's just off the fringe. Coming back, this for a par. Oh, and just missing on the left side. He wanted that. And we go back now to Henry Longhurst.
Now, Nicklaus, I reckon in length he could make this green in two. But there's this huge fir tree exactly between him and the flag. Sounding good. And it's very nearly up to the green on the left-hand side, just short of the bunker. And Lee Trevino also had a tremendous hit at it, and he's just beside the bunker on the right. They're much nearer than we saw anybody else on either day. They're both in the grass. So we go back to Frank Gifford.
Arnold Palmer with the short putt, but they're all dangerous here today. This for his bogey. Palmer over the green in two, across the green in three, chip back to this position. This for the bogey, which he picks up here at 16. He'll move over to 17. An awesome hole coming up for Arnold Palmer. He now trails Jack Nicklaus by three shots. And we'll go back now to Henry Longhurst and Lee Trevino.
And now we'll go back and see the tape of Trevino's second shot at the long 14th. You see, he really hits it as hard as he possibly could. And it comes right up, nearly onto the green, just short of the bunker on the right-hand side. Very fine shot, but he's got a very, very tricky one to follow, to just sort of nick it over the edge of the bunker and try and stop it with the wind behind. Yesterday, practically nobody got within 90 yards of the green in two. Now, Nicklaus has very nearly made the distance with an iron. He's in the grass just on the left, that's his left, of the big bunker there, and he's going to have a very, very tricky little shot out of that. It's that sort of grass that seems to seize on the club head and twist it round. And he's got as much sand to go over as he has grass. Pin is only 18 feet on the green. So he's got to elevate it out of that rough stuff, get it up onto the top and stop it. Be a really masterly shot if he gets it within 10 or 12 feet. Total distance about 20 to 25 yards. That's the shot he has to play. The hole completely ringed by spectators, five or six deep. And now, here he comes. Oh, that beautifully played. It just pitched on the fringe, which pulled it up. And he's no more than 5 feet away. A little bit, a tiny bit of luck went with it, but then you've got to have that. Beautifully executed shot. And now Trevino. There's another fine shot, not quite so near. She seems quite happy with it. Now we go to Chris Schenkel.
And here's your first look today at the par 3 17th. 218 yards long. You can see the velocity of the wind on the flag on an hourglass green lying in a huge ring of bunkers is Arnold Palmer now, who is 6 over par, a round of 78 going, 3 shots away from Jack Nicklaus, Palmer, Crampton, and Blancas at 6 over. Quite a face.
You notice he had his hand on his wood there, Chris, and he stuck it back in the bag.
Remember yesterday he used an iron and found the bunker right before the green.
Finally went for the wood because he realizes he must get a two here, and he can't really, I don't think there's any way he could reach this green 218 yards away with an iron because that wind is quite strong, even as strong as Arnie plays with a one iron.
In addition to facing the wind, you're looking into the sun as well. While Arnie's deciding, back, here's Henry.
Back on the 14th, Trevino from about 10 feet. At for a birdie. Go on, then. Well done. So that's a birdie for Trevino. Brings him from 7 to back to 6. Now back to Chris Schenkel.
So we have a four-way tie for second, and Arnold has gone to the iron now, Byron.
Yes, well, he may be expecting to play out to the right part of the green. If he knocks it there with an iron over that, then I'll be greatly surprised, even for Arnie. That's what I thought. He knocked it out on the front part of the green. This is the green we've talked about, this hourglass, hourglass green, and he's got about a 70-foot putt for a birdie.
And does he need a birdie? Wow. Okay, Henry.
And now back to the 14th. Here's this crucial putt for Jack Nicklaus. If he could just make this, he'd almost spread eagle the field. This for a birdie on the long 14th.
Go.
Yeah, oh dear. Well, nothing's safe on this green, so we'd better just see him safely in here. Which it is, and that's a par 5 for Jack Nicklaus as he leaves the 14th green. And you're watching the championship of the United States Golf Association, the U.S. Open. And our color coverage will continue in 1 minute.
He's 5 over.
Just one of the many beauty shots here at Pebble Beach, Carmel Bay. And a thing that was beautiful to Bruce Crampton was a birdie at the 15th hole, which puts him into second place all alone. And 2 shots off the lead now, as Jack Nicklaus is 3 over, Crampton 5, Trevino, Blancas, and Palmer 6, as we look at Arnold trying for a birdie. A long putt at the par 3, 17th.
Chris, he's got to come mighty close to that long grass there with a putter to barely skip by the edge of it. It's very difficult to get the ball close to the hole from where he is. See, he even went up into the edge of that grass. And he's going to have a tough putt left to save his par, really.
All right, that'll be a putt for a par three at the 17th. Let's go back just a moment and slow motion the tee shot with the iron.
All right, of course, naturally you realize he had to hit this iron quite hard, so you notice that he'll keep his head still. He'll get a long extension. This is unusually high for Arnold to get his hands, and he'll move through from his left shoulder, left arm, very fast down this ball because he's got to hit it hard. He's really staying down and through the shot.
Okay, Frank Gifford.
And this is Bruce Crampton on the tee at 16, who just birdied the 15th hole to move into sole possession of second place, two shots off the lead of Jack Nicklaus. And again, the players using either a 3-wood, a 4-wood, or in some cases even an iron off his tee, trying to place the ball, which is so important here at 16, 400 yards, not long. Bruce Crampton, one of the steadiest players over the last 4 or 5 years, has never, however, won a major championship. And Crampton in the fairway on the left side as we go now back to Chris Schenkel.
All right, and this is a putt by Arnold Palmer at the par 3, 17th for a par. Ooh. A par three for Arnold Palmer at the 17th hole. He is trailing by three with a hole to play. Ernie's card today, well, sort of interesting. One birdie and five bogeys.
And that's in the middle of the fairway. You can see Lee Trevino. He is going to hit first. Probably he might have used a 3-wood, 2 off the fairway, I mean off the tee, don't you think, Dave, or not?
Well, I think Lee's such a good driver that he probably hit a driver there. And Jack, I would assume he's been hitting a 3-wood, I understand, off this tee. But he's extremely long with any club he's got. That's why he's ahead of Lee there a little bit. And maybe Lee is tiring, as he's said all week. You know, he's played really remarkably well, considering all his problems.
He's at about 256 yards, has about 150 yards coming in here. I think the amazing thing about the day so far, we only have one, if my records are right, one subpar round. That was by Mason Rudolph, who was first off with a 70. The amateur Jim Simons, who is a leading amateur, had a 72. He is in at plus 13, and Tommy Kite is in at plus 14. The leader in the clubhouse right now is Chichi Rodriguez, along with Cesar Cernuto at plus 11, plus 12, Billy Casper, Bert Yancey, and Bobby Nichols. As we go back out to Lee Trevino again, he has about 150 yards coming in here.
He's got a little bit of a downhill lie, but it shouldn't bother Lee too much. He'll play some sort of left to right shot in here, I feel like.
It's right on the flag, if it isn't too long. And just holds up. He's about 25 feet away from the pin, and boy, is that going to be fast. And look at Arnold on the 18th trying to figure out exactly what he has to do. He's played it enough. And now we're on the 17th as we switch back to Lee. A little discouraged with that. And to Jack Nicklaus, who's out about 10 yards ahead of Lee. He's out about 260, gives him about 150 or 145 coming in here.
I think Lee might be a little discouraged, Bud, because where he put it, it's almost impossible to get down in two.
It is fast from there. He's downhill. Jack is parred, bogeyed and parred this hole in his rounds of 74, 72, 71. He's played the back nine the first three rounds at one under par.
Looks like he's got about an 8-iron there, but it's see the rounded end of the club, the head of the club.
And look at that one, about 12 feet, I would say, at most. Jack Nicklaus, he has uphill putt coming up, a very fine shot by Jack Nicklaus. Chance for a birdie. I'm Bud Palmer, and with me is the former PGA champion Dave Marr, whom, like many top golfers, did not survive the cut here. But Dave, you did play two rounds here, and what about these final holes from 15 on in? They are tough.
Well, just like the rest of the course, Bud, they're great holes. 15 and 16 are not very long, actually. You might see some of the players using 3-woods off the tees to keep the ball in the fairway, because they are holes where if you keep it in the fairway, you can make birdies. And then you have 17, which is, I think, probably will be a wood shot today for most players. Very long par three, straight into the wind and a great hole. And of course, 18 along the ocean is a par five that probably can't be reached by most players. I would say Nicklaus is the only one that probably could, but a hole you can birdie.
Well, let's take a look at the 15th now, right now, and here's the model of it. Dave, you played it. How about describing it?
Well, there's your tee area and the barranca just in front of the tee there. You must stay away from those trees. It's out of bounds to the right, and you see the perfect place to try to drive. And you second shot, you try to avoid the traps and the crosswind.
Now let's go to Frank Gifford on 16.
Thank you, Bud. And David also played 16, and I know he would kind of characterize this hole as being a little delicate. He mentioned that the players will be using either a 3 or 4 wood or possibly an iron, a 1 iron or 2 iron in this hole, because you must place your drive very carefully. Here's the ideal position. There's a fairway bunker on the left that you must avoid. There's a fairway bunker on the right. There are trees on either side of the green as you hit your second approach shot. There is out of bounds on the left, and here's how the golfers have played through 54 holes. Now over to Chris Schenkel and Byron Nelson.
And there's always excitement, Byron, at 17 and 18 here at Pebble Beach, including yesterday as Trevino made 2 birdies on the final 2 holes while Jack Nicklaus parred them both.
Yes, there are 2 magnificent finishing holes. Here's the model of the 17th hole, 218 yards. You see all these bunkers around this 17th hole. And then, of course, I don't know really how many more, hard to count even. And all the way around the green and back, especially on the left side with the wind blowing today, you'll see a lot of balls that probably could even go in the water. Then this the unusual thing about this 17th hole, you see how they play it. The pin can be placed on the right or on the left, and it could be a club and a half more from the on the left-hand side. And this is where the pin is going to be played today. And you'll see wood shots and a lot of people that would be doing other than that today.
And of course, then you make about a 95-degree turn as you play the 540-yard par 5 18th.
Well, yes, this is one of the most scary-looking holes in the world. This is the ideal driving position just to the left of those 2 tall pine trees out into the middle of the fairway. Then you have to miss the water all the way along the left and the bunkers. The ideal place is right in front of the green. You must stay a little to the left close to the water so you do not get behind those trees that will block your shot to this green. And then, of course, you see the bunkers all the way around this green. It's a little small, round green. It's a very difficult finishing hole.
And they call the 18th the finisher. Now let's go back out to more action.
And that it is. Here's Jack Nicklaus with about a 12 to 14 uphill putt for his birdie. It'll break left towards the ocean. That's where the grain runs.
And it goes in. It broke just perfectly. And that puts him at just 2 over par and gives him a 3-stroke lead with 3 holes to go. Let's take a look at it again. Jack Nicklaus looking for the second of the Grand Slams. There it goes in. And don't forget the other 2 on the tour. They were covered by ABC, the British Open on July 15th, and the PGA Championship on August 4th and 6th. Here's Lee Trevino for his par. He chipped to there, broke sharply to the right, looked good almost all the way until the grain and going towards the ocean caught it. But that's a par 4 for Lee Trevino as he goes off with Jack Nicklaus off the 15th here with Jack enjoying a 3-stroke lead. Let's go to Chris Schenkel now.
Homero Blancas is on the 18th green, another of the small ones here at Pebble Beach. Homero Blancas, who in the championship is 6 over par, or tied for 3rd with Lee Trevino and Arnold Palmer, as Jack Nicklaus with a birdie at 15 is now 2 over, Bruce Crampton 5 over. This is a putt for a par, and Homero spent a great deal of time, Byron, in the bunker before he came out of it.
Yes, they had some sort of a ruling there in the bunker, and I don't know what it could be, but at any rate, had 2 USGA officials there with him, and then he dropped the ball, so.
On the right, you see Bruce Crampton, and what a fine par 5 for Homero Blancas at the finisher, the home hole, the 72nd hole in this championship. Homero Blancas is, after regulation play, in at 294. Okay, Frank.
Bruce Crampton putting for a bird to move to 4 under par. He heard the roar from the 15th green a moment ago when Jack Nicklaus
made his birdie. But this for Bruce Crampton is also a birdie. And two difficult holes left. It's on its way, very slippery. And it breaks off. We go quickly to Chris.
Arnold Palmer's second shot on the par 5, 18th hole. Hit a fine drive and in perfect position. And he is before the green, and I thought he'd be much closer. Back to Frank.
Jack Nicklaus with the three-shot lead coming off the tee at 16. Crampton picked up his par to remain 5 under par, 3 shots behind Jack Nicklaus. Nicklaus has gone on the left side of the fairway. He'll have a shot to the green in good shape. Jack Nicklaus with so much pressure, and is it ever going to continue to build? Should he hold on and win here today, as it appears he might well do? Lee Trevino, who came into the tournament out of the hospital bed in El Paso with the pneumonia that he picked up at White Marsh. Lee said when he went off today, "I don't have any pressure at all." He said, "No one expects me to win." He said, "If I should, that'll be fine." Off the tee at 16, Lee Trevino. At 6 over par, 4 shots off. Always talking. Go, baby, and he is in absolutely dead, perfect position here at 16. So both Nicklaus and Trevino laughing. This twosome, of course, last year in that memorable playoff match at Marion. As we go back again to Chris Schenkel.
And here's Arnold Palmer moving up the 18th fairway. He is 6 over for the tournament. He started out at 2 over, so he's 4 over on this round. Let's look at other scores, other finishers, as we indicated. Homero Blancas is in at 6 over par. And you see Tom Weisskopf, 8. Chichi Rodriguez, 11. Don January, Bobby Nichols, Billy Casper, 12. Gary Player, and Orville Moody, 13. Jerry
Some great
Hurd.
Players along there, way over par. This is National Open scores, Chris.
As you see, George Archer, he had an 87 today here at Pebble Beach. And earlier, there was a mention made of Mason Rudolph's 2-under round of 70 today. What a switch from an 84 yesterday. Of course, Arnold Palmer opened with a 77 here in the 72nd Open. Came back in the second round with a 68. But he certainly would like to have done better here today. He is 4 over on the round. He is taking a look at the distance, which we would measure at about 100 yards from the flag. And from one of our 23 color cameras in a crane behind the 18th green here, you get a high-up shot down on one of the most photographed golf holes in the world. Pebble Beach, carved out of Del Monte Forest, a 5,600-acre preserve, which was discovered by a young man from Massachusetts in about 1908, Samuel Finley Brown Morse. Right here by Carmel Bay. The seawall, the rocks. All right. At the 17th tee now, Bruce Crampton, who's all alone in second, 3 shots away from Jack Nicklaus, the leader, with a wood. We have a diminishing wind now as it becomes a little later in the afternoon here in Pebble Beach, California. You can see that the flag, and Bruce Crampton has found the bunker. Arnold Palmer taking a lot of time with his third shot on this par 5, 18th hole.
Chris, I'd say he's probably going with a strong wedge because the pin's cut real close to the front of the green. So he must stop the ball very quickly. There's been a lot of people who have misjudged this shot today and left the ball in the face of that bunker in front. Have had a lot of problems, so.
And Jack Nicklaus at the 16th hole is wondering what club he should use. The 16th hole, a 400-yard par 4, while Arnold Palmer is on the 540-yard par 5, 18th.
A lot of indecision or decision one, Chris, whichever you want to call it.
All right, it goes back to the golf bag. Two greats in action.
Very unusual to see a split screen of these two great players.
Arnie chose the right club. Let's see if Jack did. Well, just off the putting surface at the 16th hole, Jack Nicklaus on the right, while Arnold Palmer has delighted his fans with a super third shot on the par 5, 18th hole. You're watching the United States Open played at beautiful Pebble Beach. Action continues in a moment. Now we have three of the greatest golfers in the world in view of our ABC cameras. Split screen on the right, Jack Nicklaus, Lee Trevino. Meanwhile, on the left, Arnold Palmer lining up a putt for a birdie four at the home hole.
Chris, it's fast as glass on there, and he'll break it slightly to his right.
You can almost see the strain, the pressure on these golfers' faces, Byron, of the United States Open, and it's a par five for Arnold Palmer, and after regulation play, Arnold Palmer is in at six over, 294 for the 72nd Open, and we make a correction on Romero Blancas' score. There was a ruling in the bunker. He made a bogey instead of a par, so he's in at seven over. So the leader at the moment is Arnold Palmer, but out on the course, it's Jack Nicklaus, four shots better. And speaking of the leader, there he is. And here's Frank Gifford.
Well, Jack Nicklaus, of course, as you saw a moment ago, put his second shot just off the edge of the green, just on the fringe. But he has a very difficult putt. Byron Nelson mentioned the slipperiness of the green at 18. From where Jack is, we have watched player after player three putt this green. It is lightning fast coming down, a slight break to the left. And what a steady and concentration. One of the really great champions, not only on the golf course, he's something else off. Always has time for anyone. Totally dedicated to this game and in pursuit of, well, something everyone seems to think cannot be done, the Grand Slam. Right now, a three-shot lead over Bruce Crampton. Two holes remaining after this 16th. Bruce Crampton looking over his putt for par at 17. Jack, of course, for a birdie at 16. Chris Crampton, who has never won a major title. Nicklaus, who has won so many, two U.S. Opens. So Crampton remains three shots off the lead. And now this difficult putt for Jack Nicklaus, about 52 or 53 feet. And is it ever slippery?
It hit the hole, and had it not hit the hole, it would have gone by perhaps another 4 or 5 feet. He still has a considerable putt coming back for par, but what a line Jack Nicklaus had on that putt. He shows you something every time you watch him. Lee Trevino now, looking over his putt. He'll have a putt of about 40 feet. Will mark, of course, and do a little house cleaning as Trevino goes back to his ball. His putt will break off to the left just a little bit. And coming up just a little short is Lee Trevino. And he will have this remaining for his par. Trevino at six over par, four shots off the lead. And two dynamite holes left, 17 and 18.
And while Jack Nicklaus steadies this putt, let's go to Chris Schenkel.
Bruce Crampton in second at five over as it teed up at the 18th. Again, that smooth swing, Byron.
Yes, he just stands up and smooths it out there most every time he hits it.
So it's come off to the right into the crowd as we look at Lee Trevino. Back to Frank Gifford.
This for Lee Trevino's par at 16, which he has. He remains six over par, four shots behind Jack Nicklaus, who has a considerable putt coming back. He made a great putt from where he was, his birdie attempt, hitting the back of the cup. And he'll have a little over 4 feet. We'll call it about 4 feet. Again, the green so slippery, the wind has dried them out considerably. Of course, they're cut to U.S. Open specifications. And that means down the glass. This for his par four to remain two over par. And Jack Nicklaus gets his par four at 16. You know, over 4,000 entrants tried to qualify for the U.S. Open this year. Now it's the tension-packed final round. ABC's exclusive coverage continues in a moment.
Incomparable beauty here on Carmel Bay. And a beautiful golfer, Jack Nicklaus, has a three-shot lead with two holes to play. Three strokes ahead of Bruce Crampton. Back to the beach. And a lot of golfers have found sand here today in a most unusual fourth and final round of the world's most important championship. And on one of the world's greatest golf courses, you look at a nifty par three, the 17th. And on the tee, Jack Nicklaus, your leader. Very scientific, the approach that these golfers take to the game now, Byron, with their little charts and information. Meanwhile, here on 18, Bruce Crampton, who is all alone in second by a stroke. Back to the golf bag, Jack Nicklaus, he has selected an iron, it appears, for the 218-yard par three. And at 18, the gallery moving back, so Bruce Crampton will have plenty of room.
I'm sure that Jack on the 17th will play to that short part of the green out in the front right, which is a club and a half short of where the pin is. The wind has let up a little bit, and he might really let go with one and try to carry it back into the back part. But I would guess that he will try to play the ball more on the safe side today.
He's really a well-organized golfer.
Yeah, he's a very well-organized person. He just very methodical.
Who today could equal Bob Jones' great championship record of 13 major wins.
The wind has let up a little bit right now. He may go for the big part of the green instead of the little front right. We'll just have to wait and see. But you'll see him really stay down to this one, because this hole can give a lot of trouble. Almost made a hole in one, Chris. That's the most remarkable shot, I think, of the entire championship right there.
You know, like the late Bob Jones says, he plays a game unfamiliar to all of us. Jack Nicklaus, look at that.
Well, it just makes you speechless. You just don't know what to say when the golfer is that good under the pressure.
Now I can't wait for the British Open, Byron, at Muirfield, which we'll televise, and the PGA. Lee Trevino, the defending champion. Trevino, six over. Tied for third with Arnold Palmer at the moment.
I'd like to hear Jack's comments after the day is over. There's Lee out on the front part of the green to see how great he thought that shot was.
He'll have a Phil Harris or Bing Crosby putt at 17, believe me. Not Jack Nicklaus. All right. All right, Bruce Crampton now with his second shot on the par 5, 18th. Bruce at 5 over. Trailing by 3.
He's part of the road there. You know, as he's digging around this spike, that's where the equipment goes through there and where the people have walked. It's not an easy shot that he has. Must hit the ball first on this for sure. If you hit behind it, you won't get anything.
He's found the fairway here at the 18th hole. Well, you know, here the Del Monte Forest and Pebble Beach made an invaluable contribution to the preservation of natural beauty, and here's what we mean. Almost makes you want to throw stones at your own home area. It's just beautiful here. As we have over 200 ABC personnel with 23 color cameras and a man watching at home because he's recovering from hepatitis, John Crowder, an engineering supervisor, had a lot to do with setting this up. We hope you're enjoying it, John, as we look at Trevino. Jack Nicklaus, of course, tapped in for his birdie 2 at the 17th hole. This is for a par 3 for Lee Trevino. So it will be a bogey 4 at the 17th for Trevino, putting him 7 over par for the championship. Quite a defending champion. Meanwhile, as we look at the 18th green, we go back out on the fairway, the crescent-shaped fairway here by the bay. It is Bruce Crampton, who is 5 over, 4 shots away from the lead. And he could possibly be the man to finish second behind the great Jack Nicklaus. Just on the fringe here at the 18th green before Del Monte Lodge, as Jack Nicklaus, 540 yards away, gets ready to hit his drive at 18.
I think he's using a 3-wood, Chris, so he will not drive the ball too far across the fairway.
What a feeling, leading by 4 with 1 hole to play. The man that won the 1972 Bing Crosby Championship right here. Are they Mexican? No. There it is.
He didn't intend to come that close to that water, I'm sure, Chris, but it's in the fairway now, nevertheless.
You know something, Byron? If Jack pars this hole, your prediction will be right on the button.
Well, that would be most fortunate, Chris, but we were here and we, as you see, Trevina driving there. Trevina's done remarkably well in this tournament. But when you've played golf as long as I have, why, you look at the course and you try to determine the problems they'll have and try to guess.
Yeah, but you do it all the time. You did it at Baldesraw when Jack won. You predicted the exact score, 275, in that victory. From Pebble Beach Golf Links in Pebble Beach, California, you're watching the United States Open Golf Championship. We'll return in a moment. If you're watching in color in the pink sweater, that is Bruce Crampton. He's looking over a long putt here at the 18th green for a four on this par five hole. He is in second place, all alone, at five over, four shots away from the leader, Jack Nicklaus. Arnold Palmer is six over and finished with regulation play.
Chris, it's fast and it'll break to his right, but he has a wonderful touch, this man. He just keeps rolling it along, rolling it, rolling it. Excellent putt from there.
Right, and he'll have that short putt for his par five at the home hole to finish at five over par. Kermit Zarley, eight over as he birdied 17. While they're arranging things here, let's get a slow-motion view of Jack Nicklaus's tee shot on the final hole.
Notice how beautifully his hands led this club, and see how nice and high his hands are. So many of us swing the club down and low and too much around, not high enough like this. His weight's balanced well back on his right side. He moves through very... Look how well he's staying down. See, look what his head, how his head is, how straight his left arm is, and how beautifully he used his left side. And, of course, his weight's finished now nicely over on his left foot.
Well, that was with the wood. Now let's watch him with an iron, his second shot here on the par 5 18.
From this position, you know he's going to play the ball right out into the front of the green because he's not going to take any chance of getting into the water. And he did. He played too far to the right, actually, but it's still just in the edge of the fairway, leaving him slightly blocked by this tree, but not much.
Jack Nicklaus, who has two victories in the United States Open, on his way to his third, as we look at Lee Trevino, who has won the Open twice and is the defending champion. His second shot at 18.
Actually, he's done a marvelous job of defending his title. It's a very difficult thing to do, and under the circumstances that he's had, illness.
Well, the Open is always the blend of the old and new among amateur and professional golfers. The greats have won this championship. And we're going to show you the previous winners going all the way back to Horace Rollins after Bruce Crampton finishes 72 holes of play as a short putt to remain five over and in second place worth $15,000. Third is 10. So this is a
$2,500 putt.
$2,500 putt. And there, ladies and gentlemen, is your runner-up in the 72nd United States Open. The runner-up or second place. Let's look at the past winners. champions, and as you saw, Jack Nicklaus had won it in 62 and 67. And, of course, Jack Nicklaus on his way to winning his 13th major championship. And the second leg of the Grand Slam, combining this with a great Masters victory this year, now the United States Open here at Pebble Beach, and his two challenges still to come, the British Open at Muirfield, the Oakland Hills PGA in Birmingham, Michigan. His third shot on the par five, 18th, is on the green, about hole high.
You notice he played quite a bit of left of the flag, Chris. He did that because the tree was guarding him just a little bit. He wanted to play the ball safely out into the center of the green.
Now Lee Trevino, his third shot. Up in the air. So it appears from our location behind the 18th green that Jack Nicklaus will be putting first as he is away. And there you see the spectators who have come from all parts, not only this country, but countries the world over. Hugest press tent ever in the history of the United States Open. Over 500 writers, reporters from many countries, and to record for you, as we have, the third United States Open victory by this man, Jack Nicklaus. Look at that.
Chris, he'll be, according to what I find out right quickly, he'll be the only man who's ever won it for the third time. There have been some four-time winners and two-time winners. And then, of course, he's got a lot of time to go yet.
Right. Four-time winners, Willie Anderson, Bob Jones, Ben Hogan. So this man will be the only one to have won it three times. And these are the men, as a result of their finish here, that have qualified for next year's United States Open, which will be played at a course called the Monster, Oakmont, in a suburb of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. 15, top 15 plus ties. Oakmont, 70 years old, nestled in the Allegheny Hills. And Tom Armour, who won it in 27, called it a cruel and treacherous playground. It's where Nicklaus won his first Open in 1962 in a playoff with Arnold Palmer. The defending champion, Lee Trevino. He thought he had it. Lee Trevino at 7 over. This short one for a par 5 at the home hole. He'll join Homero Blancas at 295. And here's the cheer for a great guy, great golfer. Of course, we'll see him in Muirfield defending his British Open championship. And his chief competition will come from the man in the lemon sweater, whose game is nothing like a lemon.
Boy, I'll say not. He seems to play just when he wants to. He seems to have the ability to rise to the occasion and plays absolutely.
You know, we'd
gets
really
up for all big tournaments.
You know, in an unprecedented golf telecast, and right here on ABC, it's due to our executive producer, Ruin Arledge, our producer, Chuck Howard, our directors, Mac Himian, Andy Sedaris, and Jim Jeanette, technical directors, John Allen, John Broderick, and Bill Morris, associate producer, Terry Jastro, associate director, Jack Gallivan, engineering folks, Lynn Bottom, Bob Armbruster, and Dave Seeley, and John Crowder, who unfortunately, because of illness, couldn't be here, unit managers, Marshall Lopez, Bob Piatak, and Gary Posner. Our thanks to Bob Goodrich and Bob Kelly as well, and all of you for watching. Now, Jack wouldn't dare spoil your prediction by making this putt, Byron.
He'd be all right.
It would put him even for 72 holes, if he makes it. Give it a try.
He gave it a try, that's right.
That was his fourth stroke here at the par 5, 72nd hole. And that three-footer coming back for a par 5.
Of course, it doesn't mean anything for him about him winning the tournament, Chris, but he has a tough little putt to make. but it's pretty easy at this point.
As Jack will do later, we'd like to do now congratulate the general chairman, J. Arch Butts, the honorary chairman, Bing Crosby. And here's the man that won Bing's tournament right here in 72 in January, Jack Nicklaus. Jack.
Told you that putt was hard.
That is the third Open Championship, the 13th major, and congratulations from Lee Trevino, who won it last year. Jack Nicklaus has won it 2 over par, or 290, here at Pebble Beach. And now we know why Bing Crosby chose this site for 2 rounds of golf in his annual clam bake. He did it way back in 1947 because it is a true test of this royal and ancient game, Byron.
Yes, it's one of the great tests of golf. It always has been. Of course, this is a little unusual to see so much rough here. It's the first time they've ever played a championship with this much rough, and I was glad that the wind did blow some today to let some of the players who had not had the opportunity to play this course to see how difficult it was and difficult it is to play under, we'll not say severe, but under good, difficult conditions, because it was cool.
Jack Nicklaus has accomplished so many things, and now he has reached the halfway point of the Grand Slam, winning the Masters and the United States Open. And we'll be at Muirfield to bring back via satellite his attempt to win the British Open at Muirfield, and then again the first week in August at Oakland Hills in Birmingham, Michigan, for the PGA, the fourth and final leg of what is believed to be an impossibility, the Grand Slam. But if anybody will ever win it, it'll be that man, Jack Nicklaus, 290, a winner here by 3 shots over Bruce Crampton. Our thanks to Bill Coleman and all his staff here at Del Monte Lodge. And once again, the result, Jack Nicklaus winning his third United States Open. Air travel arranged through and a promotional fee paid by United Airlines. This has been an ABC Sports presentation.